just about to kick off. Good morning and welcome to the third meeting in 2021 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The first item on our agenda is to take evidence as part of a pre-budget scrutiny of Scotland's public finances in 2022-23 and the impact of COVID-19. We hear from two separate sets of witnesses today, with the first panel consisting of Polly Tolley, Director of Impact, Citizens Advice Scotland, Laura Mahon, Deputy Chief Executive, Alcohol Focus Scotland, Adam Stakura, Head of Policy and Communications, Age Scotland, and John Dickey, Director of Child Poverty Action Group in Scotland, who I'm delighted is able to be with us in the room today. The majority of our witnesses for this session are joining us remotely, so if members wish to ask a question of a specific witness, please make this clear and allow for a brief pause to allow our broadcasting team to activate their microphones. I'll aim to give each witness a chance to respond to questions, but if any of you wish to reply to a specific point, please indicate to me and the clerks by raising your hand and typing R into the chat function on the Blue Jeans software package. Of course, not everyone has to answer every question. It may be that some questions are directed only to specific witnesses. So I intend to allow 75 minutes for this, and members have received copies of the written submissions provided by each of our witnesses, along with a summary of evidence from the Financial Scrutiny Unit in the Scottish Parliament Information Centre. So I welcome our witnesses to the meeting, and I'd like to start this question by asking John, who is, because he's here, I suppose, he'll get the first question. That's not necessarily a good thing, John, when you've heard the question. But one of the things that you've talked of in your excellent submission, and I have to say the quality of submissions has been first class, lots of detail in it. There's one or two things that I would have liked to have seen added to that, and I'm going to touch on that just now. So you've said to question one, John, that children who grow up in poverty are more likely to experience chronic ill health, poor mental health or behavioural and emotional problems and do less well in school and their more affluent peers. And you talk about the need for preventative spend. Now, this committee has over many years looked at prevention, and we have had many excellent ideas that come forward in terms of prevention. And indeed, in your paper, you have named a number of them. But Spice have also come to us in this session, and they've said, and I quote, quoting Professor Graham Roy, the Dean of External Engagement at the University of Glasgow, I quote, "It's clear that budgets are going to be tight, not just in 22-23, but for the rest of the Parliament, with demand likely to outstrip funding available." He goes on to add that tough spending and taxation choices await as extremely high levels of debt undertaken by the UK government are addressed. So we're in a situation, John, and this is also to other witnesses who will be asking similar questions too soon. How do we deliver the kind of priorities that the Child Poverty Action Group want to see? How do we deliver that prevention? So, for example, the difficulty we had previously was not thinking about how we can spend money on prevention, but how do we and where can we disinvest in other areas that perhaps are not delivering on the kind of targets that you and others would like to see?
So, yeah, no, thank you. We're very aware that times are challenging, that budgets are under pressure. I suppose to pick up on Professor Roy's evidence, as he also went on to say, this makes it even more, the fact that budgets will be tight makes it even more important that budget decisions and the budget process focuses and prioritises, looks at what are the key outcomes that this Parliament and this government wants to achieve. And we have the First Minister saying that ending child poverty is a national mission. We have this Parliament having set child poverty targets in the last Parliament, requiring ministers to ensure that fewer than 18% of children are living in poverty by 23-24. So within this session, just two budget processes away. I suppose that gives us a kind of a framework within which to focus. How do we prioritise resources? These are very clear outcomes that Parliament and the government have very welcomely set themselves. So it's then about how do we ensure that those targets are met, that that mission is achieved, or we make significant progress towards achieving that mission. In terms of preventing those costs of child poverty, and they are, you know, they're obviously extraordinary damage to individual children and families in terms of the health, education outcomes that are put at risk as a result of growing up in poverty. But those are huge costs to us all. And across the UK a few years ago, work we commissioned estimated that the cost of child poverty was £29 billion a year. So the costs of not investing now to reduce those levels of poverty are significant. So that's, I suppose, that's the framework within which we need to think about how do we focus resources on tackling poverty. The other, I suppose, key point we would make is that there is no route to achieving the interim child poverty targets, the target to reduce child poverty to less than 18% by 2023-24 that doesn't involve significantly increasing the value of the Scottish child payment, which is why we are saying that needs to be the number one priority for this budget, is at the very least doubling the Scottish child payment if we're going to make real progress towards delivering and achieve that interim child poverty target. So there are difficult decisions to be made, but the Parliament and government and the government have very clearly said these are priorities, and this is where we need to see the budget and budget decisions focus on ensuring that resources are put into achieving those outcomes that have been set. And in the short to medium term, there's no question that investing more in Scotland's Social Security and in the Scottish Child Payment particularly is the key mechanism to ensuring that target and those outcomes are delivered.
Okay, well, assuming that we all accept that, and I mean, I think you've made a very good argument for that in your paper, how do we do that? Because if we have very tight financial situation, I mean, everyone is going to suggest, and everyone has suggested in all the submissions, that additional money should be spent in their particular area. But where can we disinvest? Where is money being spent in the Scottish budget, CPAG say, that could perhaps be moved into this particular area? Because I understand that doubling a child payment will cost about £163 million, which will have to come directly from Scottish resources. So it's not going to be panic consequentials or anything of that nature. So where, because this has always been the difficulty, where do we disinvest in order to invest more effectively in the areas that you and others are actually suggesting today? I mean, or do we increase taxation? If so, who would actually pay the additional taxation? How much would it be? You know, because what we're trying to do here is present, obviously, a report to ministers with strong arguments rather than just an argument that says this is really important, more money should be spent, because everyone's going to say that.
Yes. So, I mean, I don't think it's our job to find very specific additional budgets and pull money away from that. What I would say is that we need to look across budget headings, across portfolios, to look at where investment can come from. As you highlighted in your question, the costs of child poverty are borne by health spending, education spending, and so on. So this is not just about a social justice spend. This should be seen in terms of being an education spend, a health spend, a spend that looks across portfolios and looks what contribution could be made to pulling the policy levers that are going to make the biggest impact in reducing and preventing child poverty.
I mean, the scale of some of the things you've suggested, though, is very significant. So, for example, you've talked about increasing childcare to 50 hours as soon as possible for children aged 6 months to 5 years. There's two issues about that. One would be the kind of cost of that, but secondly would be the availability of people to actually deliver it on the ground, i.e. the staff who would actually work, for example, in such nurseries, as well as the need to expand childcare provision through bigger nurseries, if you want to be direct about it. So over what kind of time period is CPAG, although you've said the early spot a possible opportunity, what kind of time period do you see that being delivered? Because obviously we just had a big boost to early learning provision as of last month. I think just about every local authority in Scotland was delivering on that 30 hours. So what kind of timescale are we really thinking about there? How would you like to see that?
Yeah, so I think that's a direction of travel and a kind of medium to longer term, building on the very welcome 1140 hours, ensuring that that's been delivered in a way that is flexible, that enables parents to take up the work opportunities that are available, to take up the hours that are available, that fits with their needs, and that reaches those families who are struggling on the lowest incomes. So we need to make sure we're delivering the existing offer in a way that is accessible and includes those families, those children who most need it. So yeah, building on that is a job for this over the course of the Parliament. And I think thinking towards both this Parliament and then the 2030 targets, we do need to think about what resources does the Parliament have, does the government have at its disposal, and look longer term at both not just spending, but at tax powers as well. So one of our clear calls is in the immediate term is to actually review the tax powers that the Parliament has at its disposal to look at how those can be used in a way that will contribute to that objective, to that statutory legal target of reducing child poverty to less than 10% by 2030. I think the short term most immediate priority calls we're calling for, so that doubling of the Scottish child payment at the very least, those are the kind of resources that I think can be found within existing budget envelope that the government has, by looking across portfolios, by looking at how investment can contribute to reducing costs of poor health outcomes, poor education outcomes, and so on. But longer term, there is a question mark, and we need to look at what levers on the taxation side, the revenue side, as well as on the spending side, does this Parliament and this government have at its disposal to ensure that we do achieve that longer term goal on child poverty, which will require, as you are saying, significant investment in childcare, in housing, and so on.
Thank you. I'm sure others will want to explore that further. Just moving on to Laura, and again, another excellent paper. And you've made one or two suggestions that actually can be implemented without actually, for example, costing money, such as obviously increasing the unit price of alcohol. I mean, that's an obvious one in terms of prevention in that regard. But you also go on to talk about a public health supplement to non-domestic business rates applied to retailers licensed to sell alcohol linked to volume of sales, and the creation of a new local public health tax that applies a levy to the sale of alcohol in the off-trade. I mean, how do you see that being delivered if it was to be implemented? How much money would it kind of raise? When you say volume of sales, have you thought through exactly what kind of volume of sales you're talking about? Is it basically, 5p for every bottle of spirits, or, that kind of thing? Or is it going to be something per meterage? Can you explain a wee bit more about how you feel that would work if it was something that the Scottish Government decided they wanted to take forward?
Yeah, so what we've presented in the paper are two potential options. One is a public health supplement, a new public health supplement. And that's actually something that the Scottish Government had implemented previously. In 2012, there was a public health supplement introduced to retailers of alcohol and tobacco products with a rateable value over £300,000. So that really applied to your kind of big supermarkets who were selling both alcohol and tobacco. That was a supplement on top of the normal business rates. And that ran for 3 years. And in those 3 years, that supplement raised £95 million. It was a public health supplement. It was intended to raise money on the polluter pays principle, where you're charging a supplement to those businesses that are profiting from the sale of health-harming products. And the money was to be used to fund preventative public health measures. It was removed after 3 years. We think probably because there wasn't a clear link between the money that was being raised and where it was being spent. So what we're saying with regards to a new public health supplement is we think that's a pretty good model. We have an example of it having been implemented in the past, and we've seen the level of revenue that it could potentially raise. I think the argument we're making as well in the paper is, and more broadly outside of this evidence session, is we're asking for an uprating of the minimum unit price. The minimum unit price is currently set at 50 pence per unit. But as everybody knows, that policy was delayed in terms of its implementation by about 6 years. And by the time it was implemented, that minimum unit price, the potential of that price, had been eroded quite significantly simply by inflation. So we're asking for the government to look to uprate that unit price to 65 pence per unit to maximise the benefits of that policy, which we had already, prior to the pandemic, started to see having a positive effect on consumption levels and harm levels. At a 65 pence per unit level, it would have a much greater beneficial effect on alcohol harm, but it would also increase the profits of the retailers who are selling alcohol. So at a 50 pence per unit rate, it was estimated that the off-trade would see a 9.6% increase in their retail profit from alcohol. So at 65 pence per unit, we would expect to see greater profit. And at the moment, that profit is simply being held by the retailers themselves. So the introduction of some kind of public health supplement or an alcohol harm tax would enable the government to pull back some of that profit, using that polluter pays principle to raise much needed revenue at the moment to provide funding for preventative and treatment services, which is what we're suggesting in that paper as well. So the public health supplement would be a supplement on business rates, and it would be up to the Parliament to decide who that would apply to. We're arguing that the previous supplement that only applied to these big retailers, we don't think there's an argument to limit it to those big retailers, because you know, anybody that is selling, promoting the sale of alcohol is profiting from that sale significantly. The alcohol harm tax that we have also proposed is a slightly different locally raised tax, which would be based on the volume of alcohol sold per retailer. So it's a slightly different model, and it would more directly link the revenue raised to the sale of alcohol. So we see that as quite a positive model as well, because it would potentially undo some of the incentive for retailers to continue to promote and sell alcohol, which is something that we are keen to see happen, a kind of disincentivisation of using alcohol as a loss leader in your retail model. So they're two slightly different models of revenue raising, both with, we think, significant benefits. And I don't think we necessarily have a preference. I think the alcohol harm tax, from our point of view, would have the additional benefit of giving us access to much needed data and information that we currently can't get on alcohol sales. At the moment, we have to rely on bits and pieces of data and information about sales to try and get a complete picture of what we're looking at, but it's always incomplete and lacking in detail. The additional benefit from our point of view of an alcohol harm tax is that it should release that alcohol sales data, which enables us to get a much clearer picture on levels of consumption, how that varies in different areas, so that responses can be appropriately targeted.
Okay, thank you. Now, I notice I think there would obviously be issues about, you know, large retailers and smaller retailers and that, but you seek hypothecation of that. That's not really something that that we do with taxation. I mean, usually taxation goes into a big pot and then ministers decide how it's spent. I mean, obviously, the consequentials might go from NHS, you know, straight to NHS, because that's a political decision that tends to be made. But in terms of, is it hypothecation you're looking for? Just very briefly.
Not necessarily. No, I think what we're arguing for is the taxes to be raised locally and for decisions to be taken locally about where that money is invested and where it is spent. There are issues with hypothecation, particularly in relation to this type of tax, because you don't want to create a situation where, for example, investment in treatment services and support services for people with alcohol problems is completely reliant on the tax raised through the retailing, because then you're just creating a kind of vicious circle where your treatment services rely on the sale of alcohol, and you know, we wouldn't want to be promoting that. So what we're asking is that it is a locally raised tax with local decisions taken about how it is spent, but there needs to be complete transparency about where that money is going, because that was the issue with the previous public health supplement. It did raise significant funds, but it wasn't clear that those funds were being spent on the preventative public health measures that the supplement had been set out to be used for.
Okay, thank you. Adam, in your submission, you again talk about the need for long-term investment in preventing ill health and tackling poverty, again talking about prevention, and you go on to say that the Scottish Government should provide more funding to energy efficiency schemes. I'm just wondering, given that we're deliberating over the budget, how much more you believe the Scottish Government should invest in such schemes? Secondly, hold on, I'm just going to try and do it all at once, because I want to let members in, so I'm trying to give everybody one kind of hit here. You also say fundamentally one of the core issues that must be addressed here is appropriate resourcing, funding, local authority services. But the argument about that is, without getting into, unless you mention the specifics of that, is that the Scottish Government will just say, well, we think it is adequately resourced. Now, we may or may not disagree with that, but just to touch on that. And previously, Age Scotland, in terms of, for example, disinvestment, previously Age Scotland, to an earlier iteration of this committee where I was also convener, Age Scotland themselves, when Callum Chomsky was in the role that you're in at the moment, Callum Chomchuk, basically said that Age Scotland would support an increase in the age at which people get concessionary travel from 60 to 65, something that Mr Swinney didn't agree with at the time. But is that something that Age Scotland still supports?
So on the last question first, no. The position had changed. I think that's a good number of years ago. And I think from all the consultation we've done with older people, even as part of National Transport Strategy 2, which was extensive in coordination with the Scottish Government, really found that, you know, keeping the concession of travel at 60 was what people wanted. It had a big benefit, not only for the economy, because of looking at older workers and people who are travelling to voluntary opportunities and for caring responsibilities, and also addressing those who are in poverty, of which there are huge numbers of older people in Scotland living in poverty. So there's no organisational view that the free bus pass should increase, should remain at 60. Very much our view. Convener, you make a very good point about
the specifics. Sorry, Adam, can I just interrupt you? It was just that the reason Age Scotland did that was not kind of in a vacuum. They were suggesting that so that the money could be reinvested in aids for adaptations for older people. So the money would still remain with older people, but it would just be spent on something different as part of the kind of, you know, the preventative spend. So what they were saying was, if you don't give money to on concession to travel from 60 to 65-year-olds, you could actually invest it on improving. Now, Mr Swinney did actually, Age Scotland got a bit of a win, because although he didn't actually remove the concessionary fee, he did increase investment in that area by 25% that particular financial year. So there was I suppose by suggesting something to disinvest in, but something better to invest in, then it gave him food for thought. So that was the kind of background to that, just in case you think that your predecessor was just suggesting that older people be disadvantaged in some way. So apologies for that. I should have said that initially.
I'm not sure after all the consultation done with older people on this that then gambling on this budget move would pay off or would be welcome. So I understand that entirely. And I think it's a very good line of question you have there, convener, on the specifics of the budget. I think, along with John Dickey, it's a very difficult position for charities to be in to look line by line and see where this invests. We absolutely believe that there should be more preventative spend. It's very difficult to track. It's very difficult to make those decisions in tight financial climates, because you might not see the benefit, obviously, measurably, or for a long period of time. But with regard to the energy efficiency levels, and this is very much linked to local authorities, look, we don't have an exact figure in mind. But what we do know, and we've discussed it ourselves, convener, with regard to the interlinked fire and smoke alarms, is the requirement of kind of government policies that are enacted and then sort of enforced and supported by local authorities. Sometimes the policy decision isn't matched necessarily what might be required in reality. And that's a particular policy. While we agree entirely with the home safety measures, we do think that there are going to be challenges for those in very low income. So a decision made and the knock-on impact is for somebody else. So, you know, we're in a bit of a tricky situation where I don't have an exact figure here to say let's disinvest. But I'm looking in the broader sense as well. You know, it's how the money is spent in different areas. Let's look at health and social care, for instance, whereby in that preventative measure where integrated joint boards and health and social partnerships are meant to work, having more spend in that community from that central pot to help avoid people maybe going to hospital in the first place, which is particularly expensive and not what anybody wants, is more about operational within and the decisions made within that budget of how they were, where that money will go. But it's a really difficult spot to say, okay, let's just stop spending this and we'll spend it on that, because it doesn't always work that way. But really, I know we're in a difficult financial situation, but the preventative spend concept, preventative spend kind of agenda is really about that longer term, and there will always be reasons not to do it, but obviously very difficult financial circumstances we're in.
Yes, I mean, I think the SFHA said it would be about £6 billion it would cost to retrofit in terms of the homes for energy efficiency. So I think it's one of these long-term issues. Now, just switching to yourself, Paula, because I'm keen to let members in. I realise that, obviously, with a panel of four, it's sometimes difficult to ensure everybody gets an equal hit in terms of responding. But you've said, Paula, in your submission, you've talked about non-repayable grants and counter-tax rebates being popular. Well, I suppose it's always popular if people are being given additional funds. And you talk about, advice provision to be protecting, if possible, enhance a preventive measure. So prevention, again, is seems to be a fundamental part of what you're actually saying. Can you... you've got it in your paper, but for the record, I mean, can you give a wee bit more detail on how much additional advice provision you would like to see? Because you've talked about a £16 a tonne for every pound invested in core services. And also you've touched on the removal of the £20 a week increase in universal credit that was brought in for the pandemic and the impact that could have.
Yeah, certainly. I think in terms of the preventative spend, we saw that last year during the pandemic, the Citizens Advice Network unlocked nearly £147 million in financial gain for 171,000 people. So that's money that through saving on debts or through accessing Social Security that goes back into people's pockets to be spent in communities across Scotland. Beyond that, we commissioned analysis to show that Provide by Network was worth £245 million to Scotland the previous year. And that's in things like savings in public services like the NHS. And that's by effectively solving problems for people before they escalate to the point where they need social services or more intensive support. So we are firmly of the view that investing in advice services is efficient and effective at this point in time, but as other, clearly that's hard to measure, but for us, we believe it makes sense. We are worried, going to your point about universal credit, we are worried about what's going to happen over the autumn. There's the £20 reduction that is coming off soon, furloughs winding down, we're seeing an increase in energy prices for consumers, and all of those are a bit of a perfect storm when it comes to people able to manage their household budgets. So even as far back as May, 1 in 7 people that we polled, or that YouGov polled on our behalf, indicated that they were struggling on their present income. So for us, low incomes absolutely has to be a priority. I can't tell you, alongside other panellists, where that money should come from. But I think considering outcomes when making decisions about and deliberating on where money should be spent would be something that we would absolutely ask for.
Just one final point. So in terms of vice services, additional resources to go in, what is the optimum additional sum that you would seek in order to provide the maximum benefit? I mean, because obviously funds are unlimited and you will get a law of diminishing returns at some point. So what is a reasonable and realistic increase in vice services that would bring the most return in terms of the assistance that you provide?
We haven't actually calculated that, so I'm not able to answer that question. I think for us, it's about ensuring that there's sufficiency in the system, and certainly measures such as increasing debt advice from Scottish Government is at the moment a closed system. It's at capacity, and we are concerned about the potential for increased demand and not being able to support that. We have seen a significant growth in people using our services, so 2.5 million last year using our digital advice site, which goes to show that there is an increasing need, but we haven't put a figure on that at this point in time.
Thank you very much. And now I'm going to open up questions from the committee, and it's going to be John followed by Liz.
Okay. Thanks very much, convener. Could I start with John Dickey? Could you clarify what your understanding is of the cost of doubling the child payment? Because the convener mentioned 163 million. Now, I also saw a figure mentioned for 220 million, which would be if we doubled to £20 and covered everybody under 16. Do you have a specific figure on that?
So the figure we've been using is actually the figure Spice estimated, the 220 million figure, to cover the cost of doubling and full rollout to all children under 16, which is planned by the end of the next calendar year.
Okay, that's helpful. Thanks very much. And then also to yourself, in your submission, it says the Scottish Government should undertake and publish a full assessment of Scottish tax powers and their potential to prevent and reduce child poverty. Could you expand on what you mean by
that? Yes, so I suppose this is, in response to the how do we pay for this? How do we, and starting from the bottom line that, Scotland is still a wealthy country. There's plenty of income, there's plenty of wealth in Scotland. So the question is, and yet we still have 1 in 4 of our children growing up in poverty, and we're struggling to find the resources to provide adequate social security, adequate childcare, affordable housing. So how do we, what can we do here in Scotland within the powers that we have? And up till now, there has been some use of the devolved powers to increase revenues here in Scotland, which in a more progressive way, which is something we've very much welcomed. But I think there's scope for looking with a very specific child poverty lens, because we have this clear national mission, we have these clear statutory targets, legal obligations to meet in terms of reducing child poverty. What in the round, local national tax powers, how can, what role will they need to play between now and 2030 in ensuring that we harness that income, that wealth, in a way that ensures that we have the social security and service infrastructure in place that prevents children from being in poverty in the first place, essentially. So, as part of our contribution to getting that discussion going, we have published a book at UK level called Let's Talk About Tax from a Child Poverty Lens, and we can certainly share that with committee members, and we've hosted a seminar bringing together social policy and tax experts and officials to discuss, start looking at this through a child poverty lens. So I suppose that's where we're at this stage. But there are levers, there are tax levers at the disposal of this Parliament and at local level that can be used to increase the resources that are available and can be used in a way that improves the progressiveness of the tax system and ensures that those in the lowest incomes, the services are there to, we can afford to provide the services and the social security that are needed, but in a way that doesn't necessarily increase the tax burden on those who are already on the lowest incomes.
Okay, thanks so much. Could I switch on a similar kind of vein maybe to Adam Stachura? I think your submission, rightly, focuses on pensioners and older people who are maybe poorer. But, I mean, clearly there are some pensioners and older people who are very wealthy. And, for example, they've made a big profit in their houses and haven't paid any tax on that. If there's going to be a national insurance increase, I think that means pensioners will not be contributing to that. So do you think there's room to, in order to free up resources for the people at the poorer end, for better off wealthy people to be paying a bit more?
I mean, Mr. Mason, there's a really interesting point there. And obviously, it's very current with regard to what might be happening at UK government with regard to either a social care boost for England through NI and healthcare too, and what that might mean for Scotland. It's part of that broader thing about, you know, a fairer taxation system. I don't think it's a case that, you know, old people who are particularly well off are looking to hoard anything. But remember, there's a lot of people who might have assets but kind of cash poor in a sense. But at the same point, I think this is looking at, when we're looking at the idea of that wealth across the country and who's able to support others, try not necessarily to get just into that kind of intergenerational divide. It's a bit woolly, but you know, there are 150,000 pensioners in Scotland living in poverty. There are things that aren't taxed, but obviously a lot of people of lots of ages have wealth and assets as well. And while they might not pay tax on increasing value of homes, that will happen in due course one way or another. Whether things are sold or they sell themselves or as part of inheritance tax or whatever. But we do think it's part of our submission that looking in Scotland anyway, I know a lot of the in terms of pensions and paying of pensions is reserved to the UK government, making sure that the Scottish government does look at the mechanisms it can use to reduce levels of pensioner poverty. You know, for instance, a third of pensioner households in Scotland live in fuel poverty, but there are considerable powers in Scotland to be able to address that. But going back to the convener's point about being able to look line by line and saying where do we not spend money to address that is an incredibly difficult task and one which I'm not sure I'll be able to furnish you the best answers with right now.
Okay, well, thanks for that. Anyway, I mean, I don't know if either of the other two would like to come in on the whole question of tax and if they think there's scope for that. If not, I shall move on to my next question. COSLA made the interesting comment in their submission that the National Care Service was a distraction. And obviously we're focusing on the financial side today. We could discuss more of the care side elsewhere. But, you know, from a financial aspect, is anybody's feeling that the National Care Service is a distraction, or is it something that is worth investing money in? Well, I'm getting a nod from Adam. Do you want to say something, Adam? Sorry, John, as well.
Thank you, Mr. Mason. Just very, very quickly, it's not a distraction. The National Care Service is something which we believe, after consultation with older people, is needed, and that it's something which, you know, look, the delivery of social care across Scotland can be patchy. The financial arrangements can be very, very difficult. But a lot of this is also about kind of more central accountability for the delivery of social care, which sort of, I think, you know, particularly through the last 18 months, it sort of highlighted more and more that it was hard to work out who was actually responsible for certain things with social care. It's a very mixed and broad picture. It isn't about having necessarily a centralised system. We're needing, you know, equity of access across the country. We're needing kind of, you know, mix of different services, different range of suppliers. But, you know, it's certainly a discussion about social care, how we pay for it, how we centrally kind of are accountable for it is absolutely needed. So absolutely no distraction.
Okay, thanks so much. John Dickey?
Yeah, I mean, National Care Service is not a particular focus of expertise for us. I suppose I just want to make the point that in terms from a child poverty perspective, employment and rewards from employment are a key part of, you know, ensuring parents have decent wages, decent secure work is absolutely key to achieving our child poverty targets. That's very much, you know, women's poverty is very much interlinked with child poverty. Many women are working in care services. So as part of this discussion around the National Care Service, making sure that we're looking at employment rewards, employment security, levels of pay, to ensure that we have the, that we're through that lever, we are creating work that genuinely provides a route out of poverty for parents.
Okay, thank you. Again, I don't know if either of the other two want to come in. Otherwise, I've got a question for Polly Tolly, I think, primarily. Another of COSLA's suggestions was that a ring fencing should be removed and give local authorities, you know, more flexibility in how they spend money. And I know that's an issue for Citizens Advice Bureau, because some, I think, get funding from local authorities and some don't. So would you have a view, both from the Citizens Advice point of view, but from a wider point of view, as to whether we should, you know, central here in Parliament, we should be making more decisions, or should we be leaving more decisions to local government?
Yes, certainly we do have a view on that, Mr. Mason. I think given that a lot of local authorities' funding tends to be ring-fenced and CAB funding is not, there is clearly an issue when local authorities have less money to spend on what they term to be discretionary services like the CAB. They quite unscientifically pass cuts down to Citizens Advice Bureau. So we are in favour of making that those decisions freer for local authorities.
Okay, thank you. Well, I think that's me, unless any of the others want to comment on that point. Okay.
Thanks, John. List to be followed by Michelle.
Thank you, convener, and good morning. Could I just turn attention to what I think you all said in your submissions, quite rightly, is that the pandemic has had a disproportionate effect and disproportionate burden on many people on low income. And what we have to do in relation, Mr. Dickey, you gave an answer to Mr. Mason, which you mentioned employment opportunities. And one of the things that's holding many people back is lack of access to digital skills and ability to have access to good work. Would you care to comment on what you think the priority should be in allowing people to get access to these digital skills, which are going to be so crucial to the economy, and therefore making some of the inequality burden less than it is just now? Perhaps I'll start with Mr. Dickey, seeing you answered Mr. Mason.
That's where we have most kind of evidence and have done most thinking is around digital inclusion and children and schools. And one of the things that became absolutely apparent over the pandemic was how critical having a device and having internet connectivity was to engaging fully with school. And that was actually the case before the pandemic, but was sort of sometimes seen as a bit of a luxury, whereas we knew from our work in schools that children were being excluded, were being left behind because they didn't have access to a device at home, they didn't have internet connectivity at home, and that was already reinforcing educational inequalities in classrooms. So that's become really, really clear. That's why we really welcome the commitment that the government has made to ensuring that every child does have a device and every child does have internet connectivity. I think that needs to be a key focus. We need to be able to see in the budget process how that is being funded over the coming years. And also there's something here about this relationship between national and local government that was touched on earlier. So we need to ensure that the funding settlement is adequate to deliver that connectivity of those devices to all children in schools when education is a local authority responsibility, but also that there's mechanisms of accountability there so that we know that it is actually happening and that children aren't missing out.
And do you think, it's one thing having a device, it's another thing about the skills that are apparent and able to use it and to be able to make your job applications and all the things that are very important in accessing the job market. What do we need to do to ensure that those people who obviously have the device but are better educated about how they go about the process in the world of work?
So I think there's an opportunity here about linking up school and home life, and we know that when children are learning at school, quite often the skills that they're learning transfer into the home as well, and what they're learning. So I think there's something there to build on.
Particular recommendations on that link? I mean, in terms of the homeschool link, do you have particular recommendations?
We've got work done about the best, I suppose it's more about communicating around costs and around barriers to education. So recommendations around how, and I can share with committee members, recommendations on how parents, good practice in terms of how you communicate between school and home around barriers to learning, that we can certainly share those. On this, the actual kind of recommendation in terms of skills development, and particularly skills development for adults around digital, I'd be honest to say we've done less work on that.
Thank you, that's helpful. Mr. Stewart, in terms of, I mean, it's not just about young people we're talking about, it's about older people sometimes, those who are not very digitally able and don't have access to many of the digital formats that we do. What do you think has to happen to ensure that there is less inequality within the older age group, many of whom have, you know, got huge contribution to make if they have the facility to do it, but who are obviously finding it difficult to be part of a meaningful job?
Well, thank you very much for that. It's we do have some information in our submission there about where the challenges with older workers lie. So in the older worker sense, you know, 18 months ago, it was a shock to the system while people were almost to go at home and do the job you could with a device. You might not necessarily have used it very much, or depending on the sector that you worked in, but you're then thrust into that base without the kind of training and support to kind of adopt this kind of almost fully digital life. So this is, while we had this shock to the system, I think going forward, looking at in the workplace, is there's got to be better in the workplace first, but better continual training for people on kind of technology, on different types of software, on using this on a regular basis. A lot of this also has to be face-to-face. If you're already facing challenges digitally, then just making sure training is online doesn't necessarily address that. Obviously, the environment we've had in the last year or so makes things a lot more difficult. But ensuring is that more that kind of coaching style than kind of a classroom teaching, and you must learn this, and this is what you've now got to do, get on with it, won't work. But beyond that, we've also got to remember that there'll be people who this just won't be suitable for. It could be a virtue of, you know, a disability, and other lots of kind of characteristics among them that makes it very, very difficult. Poverty is a big factor in this as well, in terms of our digital exclusion. It's not just about the device itself or being handed a device to use, because after a few years, that will also become obsolete. But it's the cost of connecting to the internet as well, which is significant. Brand new costs for many people, which will be quite difficult to work out. You know, the data costs. There has been good research about data poverty in Scotland by Nesta. I think this was a very interesting one about the broad range of all age and the gaps that we've got there. But then looking also into older age, so we experience this every single day at Age Scotland through calls to our helpline, but people who just cannot get in touch with local authorities and services to get a blue badge. They have to go and do so online. But a lot of people, looking at the level of 350,000 pensioners, live on their own. It's not someone else in their house that can kind of help them to do this. But we're having to jump through many, many fiery hoops to try and get the access to the service that they need. But while digital expansion is really important, what we can't forget is about those that are unable to embrace that, of which there are 500,000 over 60s in Scotland without the internet, about 600,000 without a smartphone. But all the things we've come to take for granted right now are hugely difficult. So it's part of that longer term, you know, training, coaching, support that's required throughout their whole life. And actually, we've got a here and now challenge with huge numbers of over 60s that can't use it, but have not had the opportunity in great scale to adopt it. But their lives have been impacted through the pandemic by not being able to access the services that they desperately need, because things have essentially been turned off and switched off.
Thank you. That's a very helpful answer. I'm not sure if the other two want to say anything on this point. Are we okay? Ms. Tolley?
I agree very much with a lot of what Adam has said around it's not just about skills, it's also about cost and people's ability to access digital public services. And again, I would also agree that providing an alternative for those who need it is absolutely necessary, otherwise we risk exacerbating inequalities further. I think there's also a point around availability. So actually access to high quality broadband, access to connectivity, and that's obviously something that many of us take for granted, but isn't available for everyone. So I think, you know, thinking about the infrastructure elements, but then also the cost of services is a significant barrier, particularly for cab clients. And we're very supportive of measures like social tariffs, for example, that some providers offer, and that helps bridge some of that gap in terms of the cost of the service and what people are able to afford.
Thank you.
Followed by Douglas.
To everybody. I just want to start by asking you one closed question, if you could just all answer yes or no before I go into the main thrust of my questions. My question is, do you routinely disaggregate the data in your surveys, whether you the ones you carry out yourself or whether you have commissioned elsewhere, by sex, elite gender? I can see a yes from Laura.
It would help, actually, if people would speak.
A nod from Polly. John?
I would need to go and check whether we could say that across all our... I mean, I don't think we could say we do that in terms of every survey that we undertake or every bit of research we undertake.
I think just Adam. Yeah. Right, OK, I've now realised that it's not always the best way to ask these closed questions, so I'll move on to an open one. I was interested when I was preparing for this session, rereading the questions you were asked to make a submission upon, and it kind of jumped out at me, the question around how should the Scottish Government budget for 2022 to 23 address the different impacts of the pandemic across, and I list age, income, education across places. So I myself was very surprised to see that it didn't include sex or gender. Although some of our submissions I saw from the STUC, Health and Social Care Alliance, and the Women's Budget Group pointed that out and did include some submissions. So my question to you, in the light of all the data that you supplied to us, and thank you very much for that, are there additional reflections you would make? I suspect you probably will, Polly in particular, to the particular impact on women and or girls of the pandemic, and also any costed policy initiatives that you could see having benefits to women or girls. I can see some note-taking being here as I've asked it. John, do you want to go first then?
Yes, so, I mean, absolutely, there's child poverty. Is intrinsically intertwined with women's poverty. Too many of our children are growing up in poverty because their mums are living in poverty, and that's because women are disadvantaged in the labour market and have been, coming back to your point around the impact of the pandemic, have been disproportionately impacted by the economic consequences of the pandemic. So that has added additional pressure put financial, additional financial pressures on families with consequences for children. So there's no solution, there's no route to ending child poverty that doesn't include ending the employment gap in terms of women's wages and women's earning power in employment. We also know that particular types of families are at particular risk. So. Families headed by a lone parent at disproportionate risk of children and families of lone parents disproportionate risk. So we need to ensure that the kind of policies that we know are needed to improve opportunities in the labour market, back to childcare being a key policy area and a key area where investment is needed. We need to look at ensuring that reaches those who need it most as well, so particularly lone parents, who are obviously disproportionately women as well.
Thank you for that. I'm hoping to hear from all of the other our other three panellists today. Thank you, Laura.
Yeah, I think just building on what John said, what we know about what has happened during the pandemic for people living with alcohol issues. We know, for example, that women's drinking has increased more than men's drinking during the pandemic. So it's been a kind of polarising picture in terms of drinking behaviours, where we have seen a slight decrease overall in alcohol consumption, but we have roughly a third, so about 27% of people reporting that they have increased their drinking. And what we know about those people from various surveys across the UK is that they tended to be people who were already drinking at the higher end of the scale. So those who are at much more risk of doing harm to themselves through that increased consumption. And then I suppose linked to previous discussions about digitalisation, what we saw with support services during the pandemic was that in the initial wave of lockdown, many of the vital support services for people who were needing help with alcohol issues just closed. And it took a while for services to get back up and running. And when they did, it tended to be on a digital basis, so facilitating conversations with people over mediums like this. And that obviously has an inequalities dimension to it, because as has previously been discussed, that relies on people being digitally literate and having access to the devices that they need to access that support. And in general, women's access to alcohol treatment and support anyway is lower for multiple reasons, including childcare responsibilities, their ability to attend appointments when they receive appointments and so on. So we are worried. We're worried in general about the need to invest in better access to treatment and support to people who are struggling. We're anticipating an increase in demand for support following the pandemic because of what we know about how behaviours have changed. And I think there is going to be a gender dimension to that for all of the reasons that John referred to, where you've got childcare responsibilities, you're trying to hold down a job, and we do know that women are reporting having increased their drinking more so than men. So it's a worrying picture. So I think policy response-wise, in our submission, we are saying there needs to be a real look at treatment and support for alcohol problems. But within that, there has to be consideration of putting in place appropriate family supportive, whole family support services that allow women to have the same opportunity to access as men.
Yes, no, just I suppose just come to add what I said in terms of what does that mean for budget decisions and how we use the resources of the Scottish Government. And I suppose we know that women work in certain sectors, in the certain sectors of the economy, so caring, retail, hospitality. I think there's then something about how do we use the business support spend, the money we use to support businesses, and particularly as we recover from the pandemic, how you know where that money goes. There's a potential lever there to drive up improvements to the quality of work, and one way of looking at that would be to look at it. Well, where do we know have been particularly badly affected, and where are women most likely to be working? And I think if we do that, then we can have a sort of flow through in terms of improving women's earnings, improving mums' earnings, and reducing child poverty.
Conscious of time, but could I just have the last few comments from the other two panellists if we want to contribute to this thread? Polly?
Yeah, I mean, I think 57% of cab clients are women. So we do see more women coming and seeking advice for us. And what we also know is that women tend more to be complex debt clients. So we're seeing more women coming to see us about really quite sticky debt issues. So that is of concern to us, particularly when the impact of issues like the removal of the £20 uplift on universal credit, the end of furlough, and also the increased price of energy. So all of those things are things that we'll be watching very carefully over the coming months.
Thank you. Adam, I think there was just one more response. Adam, did you want to come in before we finish off this thread?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. Just the very briefest sense, looking at the pandemic in response to it, women who have been disproportionately impacted by having to pick up extra caring responsibility, maybe having to leave the workplace, to either look after kind of children or kind of older relatives who have had maybe social care packages removed, that will have a knock-on impact in terms of future earnings, in terms of their own pension wealth. There's also, I think, I don't have the figures at my fingertips, but a greater proportion of women who are in an unpaid caring role, particularly for older people. And I think Oxfam had estimated that the value of unpaid care in Scotland was, you know, £36 billion. I think in terms of the impact on women through the pandemic, in that caring sense, it has been vast.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Douglas, to be followed by Daniel.
Convener, and thank you everyone for your submissions. If I can start with John, first of all, you have here that evidence from your cost of the school day project shows that charging for curriculum materials, lack of digital services and connectivity, cost of school trips, uniform policies, transport, school meals, etc., is excluding some young people from learning. I must be honest, I thought this was an area that local government and Scottish Government were actually doing quite well in. So is it that they should be doing more, or is there just differences amongst, you know, in different parts of the country?
There's still definitely differences in different parts of the country, which I suppose comes back to that point that I've sort of raised earlier about ensuring that the funding settlement is adequate to ensure that wherever you are in Scotland, your education, your school education is actually free. You're not having to pay additional costs that you can't afford to go on the Primary 7 school trip. You're not having to pay for a digital device that you can't afford. So there's an issue there about ensuring that we have the framework in place to monitor that what has been committed to and agreed between local and national government is actually being delivered across the country in every school and for every young person. I can't remember exactly when we wrote that piece of evidence. I think over the course of the pandemic, we saw real improvements, and there was a real effort to tackle some of these costs and to improve the support available to families. And there's some very real important commitments that have been made by the Scottish Government that I referred to earlier in terms of already increasing the school clothing grant, committing to ensuring every child has a device and internet connectivity, removing those curriculum costs. We're not there yet. So what we need to do is ensure that this budget round and future budget rounds ensures that the resources are there to make sure that that happens, and that there's a framework in place to monitor and hold to account to make sure that those children are benefiting on the ground.
Okay, thank you. Next question I had was for Laura. Laura, you mentioned the minimum unit pricing for alcohol, and I think it was your recommendation that, you know, that should actually increase. I guess, is there any risks around that it may actually increase poverty amongst some of our most vulnerable in society?
Well, we're not seeing evidence for that since its implementation in 2018. That was certainly one of the sort of key arguments during the debate around whether it should be introduced or not. People in more deprived communities experience considerably greater harm from alcohol consumption, but actually there's a much lower proportion of people in those communities drink alcohol. What you do see is that those who are drinking alcohol in the more deprived communities drink at much, much higher hazardous and harmful levels. So what we've seen with the introduction of minimum unit pricing so far is that there hasn't been a kind of negative impact on income for people living in our more deprived communities. So we don't anticipate an increase in the minimum price being a risk. Just prior to the pandemic, we had started to see some positive indications that the policy was starting to have its intended effect of reducing levels of consumption, and we saw a 10% decrease in alcohol-related deaths in 2019, which was a huge decrease compared to previous years. But really worryingly, what we've seen during the pandemic is that completely turn around. And in 2020, we saw a 17% increase in alcohol deaths, back to levels that we haven't seen for over a decade. And that's been the picture across the whole of the UK, so Scotland isn't an outlier in that respect. That harm will have been experienced more severely in those deprived communities. So minimum unit pricing has always been about trying to protect those people who are at most risk of harm. And there is, as you will all know, an ongoing programme of evaluation led by Public Health Scotland that is looking at these questions actively as the policy is, you know, goes through the motions of being implemented. So they are looking at those potential unintended consequences of the policy. And what I can say is that so far we're not seeing anything of serious concern in terms of impact on lower level income.
Oh, okay. And in terms of alcohol related deaths, how do we compare to the rest of the UK?
So figures for 2020 for England and Wales came out before the Scottish figures came out. So they actually saw an increase of 20% in their alcohol deaths. So we were anticipating something similar in Scotland. We've had an increase of 17%. And I think we were all quite... So that's unusual in historical terms because Scotland has always had, or certainly in over the last 10-15 years, a much higher level of alcohol-related death than our neighbours in England and Wales. So we are asking questions about whether our increase has been somewhat contained by policies like minimum unit pricing. We can't tell at the moment, but it is quite surprising to us that England and Wales saw a bigger hike in alcohol deaths than we did, because that's different to what we would have seen in normal times.
And I guess we're all hoping that this is just a spike because people are stuck indoors, maybe less things to do, and I guess we'll see in the coming years whether that comes back down to the levels it was before, and then hopefully even lower still.
Yeah, so what we think we're seeing is, as I said before, we know that roughly 27% of people are reporting having increased their alcohol consumption. And from UK data, we know that a lot of those people are people who were already drinking at hazardous or harmful levels. So what we think we're seeing is the effect of this kind of acute on chronic. So it's people who are dying who already had an underlying chronic alcohol-related condition and then have increased their consumption during the pandemic. And that increase in consumption in that short term, if you already have a chronic underlying health condition caused by your drinking, can be enough to tip you over into seriously harmful consequences. What we're really worried about, though, is that we have seen the pandemic kind of accelerate us towards a set of circumstances around drinking behaviour that we were already concerned about. So prior to the pandemic, we knew that pictures of the alcohol sold was being consumed at home. That's obviously, during periods of lockdown, increased to 100% at times. People are reporting having increased the frequency of their drinking. And then we have this part of our drinking community who have increased their consumption. Our worry is that those behaviours that have kind of been created during the pandemic may be carried forward even when things start to open up again. And you know, increases in online sales of alcohol and home delivery services are all contributing to that. So I think if we want to see a reduction, then further action does need to be taken around looking at how do we regulate online sales, home delivery services, to put other protective policies in place that encourage people to reduce their consumption again.
Okay, thank you. Next question was for Adam. Adam, you mentioned in your submission about older workers, and I guess the risk is that many of these older workers might not come back to work once furlough ends. Do you think there's more that the government can be doing to make sure these workers are welcomed back into employment and given meaningful jobs for the, you know, until they want?
Thank you. Absolutely, there's a big concern that end of furlough will mean that there's a higher number of older workers who are made redundant. And the challenge around that will be people potentially tapping into their pension savings early as a bridge until they maybe find a job. And we hear regularly of older people who might apply up to 100 times for jobs and not have any success in getting over the threshold. But that will then leave people in poverty or on lower income for far longer than their life. So big concerns there. With regard to what the Scottish Government can do, there's an argument whereby looking at the support for workers, whether you now look at older workers as a group likely to be disadvantaged in the workplace, being the group who are second most impacted by the labour market as a result of COVID. There's also looking at how the Scottish Government, with very limited cost, if not anything, would be to embrace and support notions and work around age-inclusive workplaces, something which we know Age Scotland works with hundreds of companies and thousands of employees on this, but to make sure there's better working arrangements, whether it's kind of flexible working, whether it's kind of support for people who are carers, but better intergenerational teams, more support in the workplace, who can actually then better upskill older workers with all the kind of tools that they need for the future. And we've heard in the past of the skills gap shortage in Scotland being over £300 million a few years ago now, but whether there's an untapped resource here with older workers to be able to meet those challenges, a group of people who are willing to learn, really hard grafters, like lots of different ages, but maybe being under supported.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Another question I had for you, Adam, was around health, and something I get contacted quite a lot about is the difficulty for people to get doctor's appointments, and if you do get one, it has to be online. So has that been a problem for more elderly people? And, is it something that the government could be doing more about?
So I think this goes back a little bit to the digital exclusion, and where there have been, and it hasn't necessarily been the case that it's digital only appointments. There have been options on telephones too, but if you consider again that 500,000 over 60s in Scotland don't use the internet on our last figures, that more than that don't have a smartphone, then that's been very difficult. But there has been research out there, again, not to my fingertips, which have identified the challenges old people have had with regard to telephone appointments, of taking longer to articulate what the problem they have is in a very short space of time, only being able to really talk about one challenge, a medical challenge that's facing them, and missing this, having difficulty actually getting an appointment in the first place. But we have submitted a number of occasions and discussed with the Scottish Government about the need to ensure that there are face-to-face options as well, that we don't just move to a digital space. And I think this really does go back to the challenge we face in health, of people at the beginning of the pandemic staying away from health services, not with any kind of criticism anywhere. We were told protect NHS, we will stay away, but then presenting themselves later with more serious conditions, the things that haven't gone diagnosed. But we do know there is a challenge in people accessing non-face-to-face doctor appointments, and what the impact will have on the health in the long term is as yet unknown, but you can assume that it won't be great.
Thank you, Adam.
Douglas a wee bit,
I would say it's what's required in the budget going forward. Let's me finish.
Okay, Daniel.
Thank you very much. I'd like to return to some of the points at the beginning. And I thought the discussion regarding preventative spend was of particular importance, especially given, I think, the real challenges we have ahead of us. And actually also particularly because we are, of course, 10 years on from the Christie Commission. And so while these things are difficult to implement year to year, I was just wondering whether the panel would reflect whether we've done enough to embed Christie in terms of the way that we both devise policy and indeed structure the budget. I think that the key word, which has already been mentioned, being cross-portfolio. So do we devise and implement policy in sufficiently cross-portfolio way? And actually, should the budget, rather than being structured around silos, be structured around outcomes? I'd go to John Dickey first, since he got the grilling on preventative spend at the beginning.
Thanks for
I think
that.
It was a grill convener.
The short answer is no. I think it's worth saying that it's hard to think of a better example of preventative spend than spend that will prevent child poverty and prevent so many of our children growing up disadvantaged and being held back as adults as a result. So, and I suppose that does bring me back to the kind of the big point I was wanting to make. So we have got caught up in talking about individual pressures on the budget, what do we want to spend money on, but actually it is about coming back to what are the outcomes we want to achieve, and is our budget process matching those outcomes? And we have got very clear outcomes from this Parliament and from this government on reducing and working towards ending child poverty. We've got legal targets, we've got a statement that it's a national mission. We need to have a budget process that matches that and works in tandem with that, and does, as you say, look across government portfolios in terms of what the contribution that is needed from each bit of government towards achieving that that goal.
Thank you. I thought I might just pitch the same question to Laura Mahan, mainly because I think some of the things you were talking about, tax, I think in some ways you were looking at actually the wider external benefits of levies. I mean, again, the way that we're looking at our tax powers, are we looking at those sufficiently in the round and sufficiently at actually the outcomes that they produce?
I think I would give the same answer as John. Short answer is no. I mean, I think there's probably a gap between policy outcomes that are set out by the government. I think the Scottish Government does a really good job of focusing on preventative outcomes and making these big, bold targets. You know, I obviously work in public health, and I think we have some big, bold targets in the public health field. And we have seen some really bold steps taken by the Scottish Parliament, minimum unit pricing being one of the key steps. You know, that's a world-leading preventative policy, and Scottish Parliament has led the way with that policy. But when it comes to spending and the kind of more immediate process of setting a budget, it is clear that the focus kind of comes much more into that short-termism, and I think there's a kind of disjointedness there. As John has said, it is about taking a step back and looking at prevention as a long-term process. Save money. You know, a lot of our submission to this committee has been about the huge cost to Scottish society of trying to address the alcohol harm that we experience. So £3.6 billion is the cost to Scotland of alcohol harm. £500 million of that is in health and social care costs. And what international evidence tells us is that the most cost-effective ways of reducing that cost are through increasing the price, reducing the availability, taking action on marketing. And I think what's interesting in this discussion is, you know, we're talking about where could the money come from. Everybody recognises that budgets are tight, but we still have these big corporations making huge amounts of profit from products that are costing our society huge in terms of both money and disability life years, death, you know, health issues. So there's a real imbalance there. So, you know, something needs to be done. And part of what we're proposing in our submission around the levies and the potential alcohol harm taxes to try and recoup some of that profit from these big companies that are profiting from the harm that we're experiencing in our communities, to offset the costs that we're needing to pay for to address those harms. But yeah, I think policy-wise, 10 years on from the Christie Commission, there are good aims and outcomes set out, but the budget process needs to match that.
Thank you. Moving on, but related to that question, there's been a number of suggestions, both in this morning's meeting and also in written submission, that we need to have a look at the fiscal framework. I wonder, thinking about Christie, whether actually, yes, we do need to look at the framework, but we also need to look at how we can use and benefit from the fiscal framework. So, you know, the fundamental outcome of the fiscal framework is if we see increases in tax revenues, we will have that money to spend here in Scotland. And I wonder, this is at the risk of making a gross oversimplification, you know, but to one way of thinking, the best way of tackling poverty and the best way of tackling inequality is to make sure that more people are in employment and that employment is well paid. Do you think that we have sufficient focus on ensuring that policy removes barriers to employment and indeed ensures that that employment is sufficiently well paid? And let's just use the living wage as the minimum benchmark for that. And I'll offer that to anyone who fancies having a go at answering it. Polly, I see you smiling most broadly, so we'll go to you.
I suppose we would probably view the national living wage is not sufficient. And obviously JRF have done quite a lot of work to determine what a minimum income standard should be. And what we find is a lot of our clients fall short of that. So it's very difficult for people to lead a dignified life with the level of income that they have, either through benefits or through employment. And that is a significant challenge, and it's something that we are thinking about a lot at CAS in terms of, well, what can we do to improve that situation? Because there's kind of two sides to that. There's the income problem and then there's the cost of living problem. So I think the Scottish Government's work on minimum income guarantee will be really interesting to see how that develops and see if we can get that to a place where it might help resolve that issue. But I think for us, that's the fundamental dilemma, is that the cost of services, particularly for those experiencing poverty, are far greater than their income level. And we talk about negative budgets a lot at CAS. That's something that people coming to our network experience every day. And I think John's point around child poverty, you know, that's an outcome that we wish to see.
Great. John?
Yes, I mean, again, no, a lot more needs to be done to improve the nature of our labour market and ensure that rewards from work are adequate so that parents can protect their children from poverty. So I suppose that's a key strand of our submission and our work. There's two kind of big pillars here that need to be strengthened and improved if we're going to make progress on child poverty. One is around an adequate social security system, but the other one is about access to decent quality work that allows parents to juggle childcare and responsibilities with employment. And as I said earlier, that's a big chunk of that is actually looking at the nature of women's work and tackling gender inequalities in our labour market. So from a budget point of view, it's what can the Scottish budget do that might actually help to improve the kind of work that's available there. And I think there is things that can be done looking at business grant support, looking at rates relief. How can we use these as levers to improve the quality of work and ensure that people are being paid decent wages, have got secure employment, so it's that they can rely on that employment, and that they're able to balance work and work and family responsibilities. And I suppose the other point I think it's worth making is that we can use this budget to help boost the economy and help to ensure that jobs are sustained and created. And we know that investing in low-income families, cash transfers to our lowest income families, has a really positive multiplier effect in terms of they don't save that money, they go immediately out into their local shops, local businesses and spend it because they need to, and that helps to sustain and create jobs. So actually investing significantly now in social security will help in terms of sustaining and protecting and developing jobs as well.
I would I don't know if Adam or Laura wanted to come in on this at all. No. Okay, so just moving on to a final, again, taking a step back. COVID has been, and it's an overused word, entirely unprecedented, and we've seen situations of all sorts that we've never seen before. But we've also, I think, seen kind of creative use of resource and indeed policy. So just to give one example, we saw a virtual eradication of rough sleeping through very direct action, use of hotel rooms. And speaking to one chief executive of a charity that works in this sector, he said that the key observation that they would make is that there was very direct, individualised action that essentially wasn't hidebound by rules and regulations and very much looked at what that individual need and that we've actually seen in many cases actually very positive outcomes because of that approach. I was just wondering if the panel would reflect if there are any other lessons, you know, like that, or indeed, you know, building upon that, that actually, you know, how we need to do policy differently and whether there are any sort of lessons to be learned from what has happened over the last 18 months in terms of doing things when hopefully we are the other side of the pandemic.
John can come in. I think another positive example has been the way local and national government have worked together to find mechanisms for getting additional cash support to low-income families in the latter part of the pandemic. You know, it took a while, but actually that happened, and really, you know, the pandemic, the COVID hardship payments that were funded at national level but delivered using local mechanisms around free school meal entitlement and provision of free school meals made a real difference to families, and we know that from the feedback we had from working with parents and pupils in schools that made a big difference. So when different levels of government work together, think creatively, find the resources, things can happen. I think it also threw up some lessons to learn in terms of where the balance of responsibility relies as well. I think, not to get too sidetracked a whole another area, but we an awful lot of families with children ended up relying on charity handouts, whether that was for food or whether for material resources, clothing, all the rest of it, cash handouts, when we do actually have a statutory system in place, the Scottish Welfare Fund, which is there to support, has a range of purposes, but also to support families facing financial crisis and exceptional pressures. And too often they didn't even know that existed or had been there'd been kind of barriers to accessing that. So getting that right balance of what is actually the responsibility of, you know, should children be ending up in food banks or relying on charity handouts for food and clothes, or actually do we need to fix the systems we have in place at a statutory level to ensure that by right families have got the resources they need to give their children the essentials.
Thank you.
Polly also wants to come in. Daniel.
Polly.
Thank you. I think I would agree with that assessment in terms of the measures put in place by governments did substantially improve outcomes for people during the pandemic. And I think on reflecting on that, what was very different at that point in time was a genuinely outcomes focused and cohesive response across, I suppose, from where we were sitting, UK Scottish Government and the third sector, towards supporting people to manage through the pandemic. And that felt probably quite different to how, you know, the normal pace of work that we would normally have with governments. And I think just thinking there and about the delivery of outcomes and Christie, there's something there in reflecting on when you have that cohesion and that focus, you can actually work together to mitigate outcomes very quickly, because we're delivered very rapidly. At the time, we all felt not rapidly enough, but if you look back at the timetable of what happened and when, the measures that were all put in place were put in place pretty quickly at the outset of the pandemic. They did work, And I think that was down to combined focus, cohesion and outcomes focus and working together. And I think it just shows the power of what can be done if that's the framework that people.
Do either of the others want to make a comment at all? Might be your last opportunity.
Right. Yeah, I was just going to echo Polly there with regard to direct interventions. Look, and it's not necessarily an advert for Age Scotland here, but where the Scottish Government were able to, with their budgets and new money, cash injections into service so that it could scale up immediately, to deliver what's required for people on the ground was successful. You know, Age Scotland's helpline asked by the First Minister early March to scale up, you know, from taking, you know, whatever it was, 80 calls a day to upwards of 1,000 calls a day for people, because there was no other service for older people to do that. The government then had to create something from scratch, and then seeing this massive level of phone calls for information, advice, access to services was really smart. So actually looking at how, you know, with regard to the pandemic, is, you know, these direct interventions where services that exist already can scale up, not always just do more of the same, but to do much more when it's required rather than reinventing the wheel. I think that was really positive. And I think the relationship there since then has been really fruitful to show the understanding from government about what services exist from third sector, from other public services, you know, from the private sector, which can be used to make people's lives better. I think it's a really positive outcome from, you know, such a difficult time.
Thank you. And Laura, just anything to add? Or?
Yeah, I think, I suppose I'm in a slightly different position because we experience similar, that kind of cohesion and coming together of multiple partners with a very clear focus and working at a much higher, faster pace than we maybe would have done, which ultimately resulted in some positives. But I think that process also for us highlighted some significant challenges, and it goes back to a point that Adam made a much earlier question about the mechanisms for accountability and transparency around what services are being provided by whom, where, funded by what pot. Because I think what was exposed early in the pandemic was that there is not a national overview of the level of support service across the country for people with alcohol issues and their families. And we did see a kind of crisis at the start of lockdown. And that's what brought the partners together, was suddenly services were just not available. And I think that's potentially, it'll not be unique to our sector, but obviously working in health and social care, so many of the services and personnel within those services were diverted into COVID response jobs away from their normal jobs. And that included at a policy level in Scottish Government, actually. So it left a kind of gap that then third sector partners had to step in to kind of fill. I suppose it exposed a weakness in the system. So putting a positive spin on that is, it's helpful to know that that weakness is there so that we can start to think about, so how do we protect against that in the future? While I wouldn't ever want to repeat this experience again for anybody, it certainly has highlighted issues that I think we knew were bubbling away under the surface, but it's brought them to the surface. So it allows us to kind of scrutinise those and think about how best to respond. And what I hope to see going forward is that cohesion that we have had in that kind of emergency response to the situation will continue as we try and build the COVID recovery, and ensuring that those things that have been highlighted are part of that recovery, ensure we're stronger in the future.
Thank you very much. That's it for me.
Okay, thank you very much, Daniel. I'd like to thank all of our guests. We're almost 20 minutes over time, so I'm not going to ask any further questions. You'll be glad to know. So I'd like to thank you all for your contributions. I'd like to thank John for coming here in person. And I'd also particularly like to thank Age Scotland for its policy on concessionary travel, given the fact that I will qualify as of tomorrow.
So, I know, who'd believe it? Anyway, thank you very much, everyone. I'll now call a halt until 20 past 11 for an exchange of witnesses and a natural break. Thanks, everyone. Okay, folks, we're just going to start in about 10 seconds. Okay, so we now move to our second evidence session of the day on pre-budget scrutiny, in which we'll hear from Kevin Robertson, Chair, Scottish Property Federation, and Joanne Walker, Technical Officer, Chartered Institute of Taxation and its Low Incomes Tax Reform Group. Joanne is joining us remotely, so again, members should make clear which witness they would like to respond, and a broadcasting team will turn on their mics. I will aim to give both witnesses a chance to respond to questions, but if Joanne wishes to respond to a specific point, please indicate to me by raising your hand and typing R into the chat function on the Blue Jeans software package. And I should declare an interest as someone who actually does own a property and rents it out. I intend to allow around an hour for this session. Members have received copies of both witnesses' written submissions. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome our witnesses to the meeting. I'd like to start the session by asking a question of Joanne. So Joanne, in terms of your submission, you said you do not wish to put forward suggestions of particular powers for devolution or specific policy proposals. I'm just wondering if you can tell us why that's the case. And also, in terms of the Scottish budget and its taxation policies, do you believe that it conforms to Adam Smith's four principles of fairness, certainty, convenience and efficiency?
Thank you for inviting me here today. In terms of offering no specific policy options, we tend not to advocate specific policies and tend to comment on policy proposals once they've been proposed. I think we have suggested a few potential areas where there might be cases for reform, and if you do want to ask me anything on those specifically, that's fine. I'll do what I can to comment on any items. In terms of the four principles, at the moment, I think it is difficult for the system to follow all four principles at one time, because whenever you have four principles like that, or CIOT has, say, you know, 10 ideas for what the tax system should be like, then there can be a tension between obtaining some of them. So, for example, the two that are readily spring to mind are: if you have a tax system that is as fair as it can be, it is actually unlikely to be simple. It's just a natural corollary of that. It tends to make it more complex as soon as you try to make it fairer and account for different situations. But broadly, I think, yes, when new policies are brought in, I think Scottish Government tends to look at the four principles and ask about them. And sometimes it specifically says that a measure is aiming more to deal with one particular principle. And you don't necessarily look at one particular, when you're looking at one particular tax or one policy, that wouldn't necessarily meet all the principles itself. What we try and look at is for the holistic effect of the whole tax system and whether that adheres to the principles.
And you've also suggested, you know, in your submission that a tax system should include simplicity, certainty and a fair balance. And you go on to talk about the seven principles for the tax system, which is it should be clear and up to date, simple, equitable, just, accessible and responsive, joined up and inclusive. And I'm just wondering, for example, given the discussions that are currently ongoing with regard to national insurance, is that a tax that you feel meets those seven principles?
I think with the current proposals that we're hearing from the UK, I have a few comments to make on those. Obviously, national insurance only affects employment income and self-employment income. So it doesn't actually even affect all the elements of income that are affected by the Scottish income tax, which covers the whole of income other than savings and dividend income. So from the point of view of having a broad tax base, it doesn't cover clearly it doesn't cover all the elements of income. And so from that point of view, yes, it's not, it doesn't really tackle some areas. And I, you know, it kicks in very early for a lot of, it kicks in at 9568 of income. So that means that the income tax personal allowance is 12,570 this year. So that's £3,000 of income that is not taxable or is subject to national insurance. So it will affect non-taxpayers who are workers, who are employed or self-employed. And from the point of view of Scottish taxpayers specifically, those who have income between the Scottish IRA threshold of 43,662 and the UK IRA threshold of 5270, they will have a joint income tax and national insurance rate. Currently it's 53%. If the proposed figure, I think, is 1.25%, so that would obviously go up to 54.25% on that roughly £6,500 worth of income that people might have if they earn that amount. But of course, as I said, it doesn't cover the whole type of income. It only covers very specific earned income for people of working age. So from that point of view, yes, it doesn't meet necessarily all those principles.
Thank you. And the next question is also going to be to you, Joanne, but I'm also going to ask it of Kevin before I switch to Kevin specifically. And that's really, it's based on someone else's submission. It's the STUC, the Scottish Trade Union Congress submission, stating that it does not agree with freezing income tax for the duration of the Scottish Parliament. And obviously governments can or cannot continue with their promises in terms of this regard. But what do you feel, actually, Joanne? Do you think that that's something that should be stuck with throughout this Parliament, or do you think that there may be it may be something that should be reconsidered? And I'll be asking Kevin the same thing.
Well, you'd be unsurprised to hear I'm not going to advocate a specific policy. What I will say is it does rather tie one's hands to make a promise like that. And I think as we pointed out in our response, the tax levers currently at the disposal of the Scottish Parliament are fairly limited. We've only got Scottish income tax and limited powers over Scottish income tax, and then all the other taxes that are national and devolved are relatively small in terms of the amounts of revenue they can raise, land and buildings transaction tax and Scottish landfill tax. So really what it leaves is with that promise to not touch Scottish income tax means that at the moment, you're either reliant on new taxes, completely new national taxes, or the devolution of departure tax, which again will raise relatively small amounts, or amendments to local taxes, in particular council tax on domestic rates and changes. But again, that obviously those revenues are more local than national. So yes, it's limited. It limits the options significantly. So
there's a sneaky way in which governments can allow income tax to go up by just not changing the kind of bands whereby fiscal drag allows inflation to move more people into higher bands. So that can take place. What's the Scottish Properties Federation's income tax, whether or not that the income tax should be frozen for 5 years or not?
Thanks very much, Kenneth, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to come here this morning to speak to you on behalf of the Scottish Property Federation. I don't know that we've really got a specific view in that. I mean, I think it's more for the politicians to decide on the policies around freezing it. I mean, what we would like to see is that other taxes are frozen and then property taxes, which could frustrate future investment in the economy, are increased. So I think that would be our view on it. So I think I can understand why governments might want to make those policy commitments, but I think there needs to be flexibility in the system to react to the economic situations. So.
Okay, thanks very much for that. Now, you've said in your own submission that our members are clear that tenants who can pay rent should do so, and those tenants who need support should be helped where a property owner has a means to do so. So can you just expand on what you mean by that and in what way that this support could be provided?
Yes, I think it was the property industry, as you probably mostly know, is dependent on investment in property, and that enables us to build and create the environment that we live in. And a lot of the money that comes into a property investment could be our own pensions, it could be by businesses. So there's various ways in which property investment is funded. And what we've seen through the Coronavirus Act is that our traditional landlord and tenant relationship in law has changed. But we think it's been good that we try and protect businesses. Our landlord members have worked very closely with various tenants, particularly the retailers, to try and help them throughout the pandemic. And I think what we are saying is that we would prefer that we revert back sooner rather than later to the existing landlord and tenant provisions and normal contract law than extending the provisions of the Coronavirus Act. I mean, I've got some statistics for you here that the BPF, which is the British Property Federation, they did a study of over 16,000 retail, hospitality and leisure property leases across the UK, and we found 77% of the rent owed from March 2020 has either been paid or an agreement reached on arrears, including payment plans, waivers and rent holidays and deferrals. This means only 23% of rent owed since March 2020 remains unresolved, where property owners and tenants have not yet been able to agree how this debt should be managed. This includes a small minority of tenants, 14%, who have currently refusing to speak with property owners, despite a proactive approach to reach an agreement. Our members are clear those tenants that can pay the rent should pay the rent, and those tenants who need support should be helped where a property owner has a means to do so. I would also just add that, if you look at it as some of the investors in property could be our own pension funds and things like that, whereas some of the retailers might be owned by private equity. So it's just trying to get that balance right. And I think while we've worked throughout the pandemic and our industry has worked throughout the pandemic with the tenants, we think that the sooner we get back to normal landlord and tenant relationships, the better, and that will help and stimulate more investment in the built environment in Scotland.
So I think that's something Parliament's going to spend some time deliberating over in the months ahead. But going on further into your submission, Kevin, you've said that, and I quote, planning and tax incentives to encourage mixed-use developments could support regeneration and help realise the ambition of 20-minute neighbourhoods. So I'm just wondering if you can maybe advise us as to what planning and tax incentives you have in mind there. And I wonder if Joanne could comment and see if she has any ideas in that particular area as well.
Yeah. Again, if I can just quote you some statistics, but the impact of the coronavirus on the property industry has been quite extreme. 2020 saw a fall in year-on-year investment in commercial property of some 50%, representing a reduction of £1 billion in activity. Our largest commercial sector, Glasgow, experienced a fall in new office demand of over 50% compared to 2019. Meanwhile, the Scottish Retail Consortium reports that one in seven shops across Scotland are now lying vacant. The BBC also reported at the weekend that more than 8,700 chain stores closed in the UK in the first 6 months of 2021 on the high streets, shopping centres and retail parks. That's 50 a day. City centres have suffered the worst, while retail parks are faring better. The store closure figures were collected by the local data company on behalf of accountancy firm PwC. So, our industry needs a fair and effective business environment in which to invest, develop and support occupation of commercial, residential and public buildings and places. So moving on then to your question about what we should do. We would like to see the continuation of support and rates reductions, business rates reductions, if necessary, throughout the coronavirus period. One of the things that our members are particularly concerned about, and I'm sure it's been the subject of much debate in the Parliament, is the empty property rates. And we feel that with the impact that the coronavirus pandemic has had on the retail sector and our town centres and the needs for us to get back to recreating them and getting people back to using these facilities. It's also been exacerbated by the internet and the use that we're all making of it. So we think it's unfair for the continuation or the existing regime of empty property rates. We think that that could hinder future investment in our towns and city centres.
Things I want to explore that in further depth. Joanne, do you want to comment on the question asked about tax incentives to encourage mixed-use development?
Yes, thank you. I agree on the empty property non-domestic rates. I attended a roundtable a couple of weeks ago that was looking at regeneration of town centres and how to do that. And it was raised a number of times, the issue of empty property rates, discouraging investment, basically because I think there's, as Kevin has indicated, a lot of retailers have gone out of business. So if an investor would choose potentially to invest in a business property, an empty business property, they then have the issue of finding a tenant. And unfortunately, because of the way the situation is at the moment, there is a fear that they won't be able to find a tenant of any kind. So then they're left with an empty property that they would have to pay the rates on. So it's acting as a significant disincentive. And I think one of the things that was discussed, one of which is out with the current powers that Scotland has, is that there are a number of disincentives to regenerate properties and regenerate brownfield sites within the tax system, both the empty properties rate, but also within the VAT regime. And they could be altered to not only encourage investment in town centre properties, but also to effectively discourage developers going to greenfield sites ahead of brownfield sites, because that's in particular an issue with the VAT incentives at the moment. They encourage going to use greenfield sites rather than regenerating and refurbishing disused brownfield sites. So obviously, that's not within the powers of the Scottish Parliament or the Scottish Government at the moment, but that might be something to consider if VAT were to be devolved, or in terms of negotiating with the UK Government and actually discussing with them what they might do.
OK, thank you. I've got further questions, but I'll leave them to the end if there's time. I'm keen to get other members in. So, Liz first, to be followed by John.
Thank you. Good morning. Can I ask about two issues which are effectively about the accountability and the scrutiny within tax and spend, which is obviously a prime consideration for this committee? It's been said several times, particularly during the last session of Parliament, and this committee, give them credit, tried very hard in this angle to ensure that there is really good quality scrutiny of the decisions that are made in the Parliament. Can I ask you both, what do we have to do to improve on the scrutiny and the accountability of the tax and spend system? We've obviously had other committees in this Parliament who've investigated several aspects of it and have come down on the side that there has been, in some cases, gross mismanagement of procurement and whatever, and that doesn't help with, you know, the public accepting what tax system exists. Do you have any suggestions as to what we could do to improve the accountability of the tax and spend system? I see you nodding, Joanne.
Yes, would you like me to come in first?
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for the question. The CIOT and ICAS, before the elections, we published a kind of joint manifesto for what we would like to see and to build a better tax system. And obviously, Scotland, we feel, has actually had a good start. You know, Scottish Government has been very consultative, taking a consultative approach, but obviously there are always improvements to be made. One of the things we would like to see that we think would help improve scrutiny is to see an annual finance bill process. And obviously that system is not necessarily perfect down at Westminster, but there are things that Scotland could change about it. You know, it doesn't have to be an exact replica of the Westminster system. For example, as we are doing now, giving oral evidence to you, the finance bill that goes through the UK Parliament, there is no oral evidence from expert witnesses. So that's something that potentially, you know, if a finance bill system was adopted in Scotland, it would allow for oral evidence sessions as you're doing now. And that would hopefully strengthen scrutiny. It would also play another role. We think it's really important to improve public awareness and understanding. And actually having a set finance bill process would actually help to raise the profile of the Scottish tax system among the public. And that would then allow to build on other ways of improving understanding. And we'd also like to see a longer term approach to policy development. Obviously, that's not always possible. And the way the Scottish Parliament works in terms of not necessarily having a majority means that sometimes it is necessary to have negotiations before the close to the budget time being finalised. But ideally, if there's a longer term approach, it allows for better consultation and better tax policy development.
Okay. That theme, do you feel that there is a need to ensure that there is greater coherence between the UK and Scottish governments about the timing of some big financial, whether it's the bill or information budgets particularly? I mean, one of the concerns that we've had put to us is that it's very difficult for planning ahead, whether it's Scottish government, UK government, because the timescales are apart from each other, and therefore there's lots of unknowns, unknown variables, which matter to government and to economic advisers. Would you feel that some of that problem would be dissipated if we could have a better coherence over timescales?
Yes, definitely. I think that has been an issue for the past few years because of various issues with delayed UK budgets. And obviously that has had a significant knock-on effect, especially given that the UK, they can publish their finance bill, but it doesn't actually have to be passed until July because they have their other ability to have a provisional collection of taxes, even if the Act hasn't actually been passed. Whereas obviously in Scotland, we have to have the budget through and all the resolutions through in March before the start of the tax year, and also for the local council budget. So it has had a significant effect. And so I think, yes, better timing, better coordination between the UK and Scottish governments on that. And also, you know, better communication maybe behind the scenes to allow, you know, even if it's not necessarily on a public level, but if there could be some indication so that there aren't rabbits out of the hat, whereby I understand that, you know, the Cabinet Secretary doesn't know what is in the UK budget, and the Scottish Government officials have no idea what is in the UK budget until the whole of the UK public does. And while that in some ways, yes, is fair in terms of planning for the Scottish Government, isn't very sensible.
And obviously, there is a question of the renegotiation of the fiscal framework, which has to take place very shortly. And again, it's been put to us that there are elements within that fiscal framework that may be difficult when it comes to a coherence between the two governments, particularly in terms of some of the technical aspects of that fiscal framework. Do you have any comments to make? I know you're not going to advise on policy, but do you have any comments to make about any of the technical difficulties of the existing fiscal framework, which obviously is 2016 till just now?
I'm not an expert on the fiscal framework, but I think having a broader review of it would be helpful, of the nature along the lines that the Scottish Government are proposing in terms of encompassing tax powers as well, and whether there needs to be more of them and also more borrowing powers. I think the one of the things that I think I'm right in saying is that the borrowing isn't allowed to extend beyond one financial year, and obviously that does significantly limit. So I think having a look at the whole package there will be really important to think about what would be most helpful to Scotland to have within that fiscal framework.
Thank you. One more question to Mr. Robertson, if I may. You made an interesting comment to the convener about some concerns you have over the question of contracts between people who are renting property and or people who are the tenants and people who are renting the property. And you felt that some of the legislation just now was the legislative changes that have taken place not being particularly helpful. Could you just expand on what you meant by that, Mr. Robertson?
Yes. For years, the property legal system has been fairly worldwide renowned, and that framework has allowed investors to come in and buy office buildings, invest in our town centres, build shopping centres. That money comes from various sources. And I think what we're just seeing, I think, through the Coronavirus Act, and the moratoriums on rent payment and the procedures that were put in place for non-eviction of commercial tenants. These are just steps that we think might, and we feel, and we are getting indications that that could potentially prevent large institutions from coming in to reinvest in our town centres if those continue to prevail, because there was a system in place that seemed to work quite well. So there is a concern, not just here in Scotland, but I know in the UK as well, that these provisions, and I think we all accept that they were necessary to protect businesses when we didn't know what we were entering to when the pandemic hit these shores. But as we move forward, we're just putting a flag out there that the property industry needs stability, it needs long-term certainty. Again, I would just make the point that sometimes a lot of the investment, it's not just private landlords, it could be county council pension funds, it could be the mine workers pension funds who I used to work for. These pension funds and investors, they need stability, and they're just not going to invest in the built environment to the same extent if they think that there's a threat that they might not be able to get the return because they can't effectively deal with the property. If someone decides they're not paying. And we think over the years, again, we've seen that some tenants are using other means to avoid paying rent. You know, we've seen it in the retail industry with CVAs, etc. So we're just flagging up that there's a potential concern going forward that if the balance goes too far, it could prevent future investment in our towns and centres. And we need that as we rebuild from where we are today.
Absolutely. Thank you. That's very helpful, Mr. Robertson.
Thank you. John, to be followed by Daniel.
Thanks very much, convener. If I could just return briefly to the empty property rates, which the convener asked about. I mean, my memory was that we had properties which were sitting empty for quite long time periods, and the owners appeared to be hoping or expecting that the property value would go up and they'd make their property that way. So it didn't really matter whether they put somebody into. And the specific example from my time, which the convener may also remember, was the post office in George Square, which sat with a beautiful building right in the centre of Glasgow and just sat empty for ages. So is that not why we brought in the empty property rates, and is there not a risk that actually it slows development down further if we didn't have them?
I think it's a fair point. I think we're in a changed world since we were thinking that way. I quoted some statistics about the 1 in 7 shops are now empty. Generally, property owners, and you know, I deal in property, I've done it for 40 years, we want to go on and make things happen with it. It's not normally through choice that you don't want to accept rent, particularly if there's the burden of empty property rates. So I would say that you know, the problem for the landowner has become more acute, and I think, again, going back to what we need to do to get the property industry back and working again, is that we need to review it. I think that's what we need to do. If people, I don't know how we prove if someone is deliberately holding back to get a higher rent, but in my experience, people are generally, when they buy a property, they want to get income from it, or if they buy it to develop it, they want to develop it. And we can maybe talk later about the reasons why there might be delays with that. So I just think it's time to review in view of the economic shock that we've had. And, you know, I think we need to do that.
OK, thank you. I mean, I picked up from your submission, and I think also from the Scottish Chambers of Commerce, comments like matching the UK tax rates, maybe cutting property taxes, incentives with LBTT. And all of these might have arguments for them, but on the other hand, if the Scottish Government, Scottish Parliament, takes in less money from these taxes, we have to maybe cut the NHS or cut local government. So, I mean, at this time when everybody's struggling and clearly the NHS is under pressure, you know, can you really justify cutting any taxes because it will have that kind of knock-on effect?
Well, I wouldn't be advocating any cuts to NHS budgets or anything like that. But I think I'm looking at it from an economic perspective and an industry perspective, and we're just making some suggestions of how we get our industry working again. If you take, you know, the rates, I think the revaluation was last done several years ago, and it's been recommended that the revaluation take place, and that's been deferred, I think, another couple of years. So things like that, you know, there's less retailers to take these properties on. So we're actually going to lose the take from the rates anyway, because there's going to be less, unless, you know, we'll still get empty property rates and people are paying that. But, you know, I think it's what we're seeing is it's potentially a downward spiral for property and for our town centres unless we look at other ways. We accept that you have to fund the NHS and things like that. But what we're saying is we also have to think of the consequences for our built environment, because we all want to have thriving town centres and nice places to visit. So it's a balance.
OK, that's helpful. Thanks. Another area you mentioned, I think, was in the planning area and planning departments, and particularly that I think maybe planning departments and councils should get more funding. I mean, maybe you can clarify for me and, because I've forgotten probably, but the general public, you know, is planning, I would have thought, might be a kind of self-funding exercise in that the fees that come in match the costs? Is that not the case?
I'm not sure that it is, but the councils, I think, determine how much of the planning fees goes towards the budget for the planning department. But I think it's down to the individual council to decide. But what we've seen over the years is that the quality of the and the timing of decisions by the planning authorities are getting longer, and we're not getting a quality service. Again, we think that might put the Scottish property industry at a disadvantage in terms of seeking investment. If we're dealing with a global pool of capital who want to invest throughout the world, throughout Europe, throughout the UK and then in Scotland, and if they've got choices to go to other cities where they think that they're getting a quicker response and that they'll get planning permission, they'll get more certainty about it, then I think that they'll make the decision to do that. So we're all competing.
You think businesses should be paid to pay slightly higher fees if they got a faster service?
Yes, I know, and our members have confirmed that. But if I can just quote you, during 2021, the annual average decision time for major development applications was 41.3 weeks. These are from Scotland's chief statistician, recently published annual statistics on planning performance in Scotland. So it was 41.3 weeks, and it's almost 8 weeks longer than the 32.6 weeks for the previous year. So again, we know that everybody's had difficulty working with COVID and adapting, and we think the planning service have done a good job in getting up and running, but we're falling behind. It's taken longer, and the number of major applications is also falling. So we need to look at all these things in the round and make sure that we can get a performing property sector, because we are quite a major contributor to the economy.
I accept that. Thanks. Right, well, maybe I'll switch now to Ms Walker, and I don't know if you've got any... I didn't ask you to come in on any of these points. If you want to come in, you're more than welcome. But the specific first question I had for yourself was, in your submission, and I think this is following on from Liz Smith, and you may already have actually answered this, but it says, you know, prior to the pandemic, Scottish Government had been considering methods of improving the tax policy making process and the legislative processes for taxes. And you'd like to see this work through. So I just wondered, is that purely a finance bill, or is there a bit more to it than that?
Well, obviously, the Scottish Government are currently consulting on a new framework for tax, which effectively deals with the policy-making process point, I think. You mentioned the legislation, the devolved taxes legislation working group was being jointly chaired by the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government, and the CIOT, we were sitting on that, and we would like to see that work picked up. And yes, hopefully the outcome of that we would like to see is a finance bill process. And that is the main thing in terms of the legislative element that we would like to see as an outcome, but for the reasons that I mentioned earlier. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And another one I'll aim at you, although Mr. Robertson may want to come in as well, I don't know. But the voluntary sector, and I think they do this every year, but you know, they've been asking for multi-year funding and a bit more, predictability, which I think also Mr. Robertson did mention, going forward. I mean, in practice, because... You know, again, I accept you're looking at the practical sides of this. You know, is it actually possible for any government, be that Westminster, Scottish Parliament, or even local government, to make that kind of commitment and to work that kind of way multi-year rather than the kind of annual process we have at the moment?
Yeah, I can see that it's probably difficult, yes, because you want to be able to adapt and be flexible. I think the business wants certainty, voluntary sector wants certainty, and that is, you know, it is really helpful. One thing we have suggested recently in relation to environmental taxes with the UK government is another sort of broad roadmap with a view to achieving net zero on climate change. And I think a sort of roadmap approach where you have a broad direction of travel, but you don't necessarily specify individual items. You've got broad steps along the way and a direction of travel so that people can understand where you are heading to, and from that gain some sense of certainty and stability is probably quite a useful thing. There was a corporate tax roadmap that the UK government produced in about 2010, so and that worked quite well from corporate taxes point of view. But yes, I mean, it is difficult, especially when you know you have events like COVID occurring, and it throws up all sorts of unexpected demands. But I suppose it's that kind of, if you have a broad direction of travel, with the caveat that you have to remain flexible.
Okay, so would an example of that be, say, landfill tax, that, you know, we basically say we're going to keep raising landfill tax to try and discourage landfill? That would be a kind of sense of direction without actually raising all the rates.
Yes, yeah, that would be an idea. And the idea may be that, obviously, you've got the separate fund to do with that you're paying into, and a sort of guarantee that that's going to continue.
Okay, thanks so much. Well, that's me unless Mr. Robertson wants to come in on any of that. No.
To contribute.
Well, Daniel, and it was just on the point that Mr. Robertson made about planning. I once read an article by a retiring chief executive of West Lothian, and he was asked how West Lothian was able to attract a disproportionate amount of investment, given it was post-mining and had been one of the poorest authorities. And he said they focused very much on turning planning applications either round within 4 weeks, either year or nay, as an indicative. And that gave them a competitive advantage with their local authorities. So it's a point well that you've made well. Daniel?
Thank you. I'm going to mainly focus on high streets and the comments about retail. So before I do that, let me get my declaration of interest out of the way. I've got refer members to my register. I'm a director of a company with retail interests, and I'm a member of USDAW, the Shop Workers Union. Get that out of the way. Before I ask those questions, I'd like to return to a question I asked the previous panel, but pitch it in a different way. So last week, the committee was looking at the impact of taxation decisions that had been taken in Scotland, which we should have seen an additional £500 million through the changes that were made by the Cabinet Secretary for Finance. But we've only seen £150 million uplift. And the reason for that is because of the fiscal framework and the way that that works, and that fundamentally that the income tax receipts per capita have increased more slowly in Scotland than the rest of the UK. I'm wondering if the panellists would reflect, what does that say about the way that we have been applying taxation policy? And the fundamental question I think that elicits for me, and that I put to the last panel, is has the Scottish Government been sufficiently focused on increasing the number of taxpayers in Scotland, i.e. getting people into work, and ensuring that when they are sufficiently well paid? Because surely that is the best way of ensuring that we have money for public services in Scotland. I suppose it's probably more for Joanne in the first instance, but I would be interested in Kevin's response as well.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. I mean, the more people we can get working and contributing, the better. And I don't think I've got much more to say than that. And, but I don't know enough about the tax fiscal system, I'm afraid.
Joanne, are there any sort of observations you have about the way that taxation operates in Scotland?
Thank you. I mean, obviously, partly the fiscal framework operates partly because of Scottish income tax, it's partly relates to different forecasts as well, and that can affect what filters through at different times. But yes, I agree. It's important for us to have more people in good work that pays well. And obviously, I mean, there's part of the tax system. Scotland only has limited Scottish income tax powers. And obviously that includes over employment income and self-employment income, but it is basically just the ability to set the rates and bands, and the personal allowance is set by the UK government, and that's set currently at 12,570 and rose quite significantly over the past few years. And that actually means that I think of something like four point something adults in Scotland, 4.5 million adults in Scotland, only 2.5 of them actually pay tax, because the rest of them are either not earning enough or not earning at all. So yes, that highlights that issue that of the adult working population in Scotland, little more than half are actually within the proper tax system. And obviously some of those will be paying national insurance contributions, because as I mentioned earlier, that kicks in at a lot lower level. But it does mean that there is a significant group of people that are not paying at all any tax in Scotland.
Thank you. So I'd like to move on to retail. I just wonder whether we are sufficiently concerned about the impact of COVID on the retail sector. So if you consider that 10% of employment it stems from retail and associated industries, the largest source of private sector employment. If you couple that with the fact that we have seen as a proportion of retail sales, online sales have increased by about 50%. And indeed, of those online retail sales, according to the ONS, about half are from, and I love this euphemism, non-store retailing, but I think we all know which big non-store retailer that starts with an A that's probably referring to or has the lion's share of. And with furlough coming to an end, are we about to see a cliff edge for our high street retailers? Because if they are trading down, 20%, 30%, which the current figure shows, that's just not sustainable, is it? I mean, what are the consequences of that? And I'll go to Mr. Robertson first.
Yeah, I think you've made a very good point, and I think that's why we're advocating a lot of the things and asking the government to pay attention to it, because we think when furlough does end and, these shops are going to be fighting for survival. And, if we have, what they consider to be penal rates and their competitors are sitting in dark factories or whatever, unable to supply online, then that, I think, that, is it really worth it for them? I mean, some of them have already adapted to the challenge, but, as someone who cares and works in the built environment, we have to think what the implications are going forward. And, we could bring in some other things that we're all keen to move to net zero and to take on board sustainability. There's going to be other costs, capital costs, that have to be invested in shops, etc., going forward to make these buildings more sustainable. So a cliff edge might be a bit far, but I think we're certainly in for major challenges in the retail sector going forward.
Joanne, do you have any sort of observations about retail?
I don't have much specific to add to what Kevin has said there, just that I think it probably requires a very broad and holistic review of the whole position.
So following on
various elements.
Thank you. So following on, coming back to Kevin, I mean, you've alluded to kind of the need to look at non-domestic rates, and that's certainly something that I would completely agree with. I was wondering if you just sort of agree with the assessment that actually the fundamental problem is that non-domestic rates doesn't reflect the balance of trade, and certainly specifically retail trade within the economy. And if you look at that non-store retailers, they're just paying rates for what is a warehouse, rather than reflecting the fact that those are sales to direct consumers. And that actually, fundamentally, even if you look at rates, it's only notionally connected to rent. The assessors essentially, they might come up with a rateable value, but there's no direct correlation to what people are actually paying in rent. So you have a system that is, in that sense, broken and potentially is a real impediment to recovery in the sector. I mean, am I over-egging that? I mean, would you agree with that assessment?
I think I would generally agree with that. I mean, I think I think there's a challenge out there. I think it's at a world level. I think the governments throughout the world are grappling with how to deal with taxing the big internet companies. So I think that is a real challenge, and I think it is unfair on the smaller retailers. For years, I think we've been fortunate when you think of it, the contribution that the retail sector has made in balancing the government books, in terms of generally the retail sector has had the highest rateable values. And now we're seeing this seismic shift that we're all involved in it, and that we're all choosing to shop online quite a lot, and particularly through the pandemic. So I think going forward, we've got a real challenge for the retail sector. And that then impacts on our built environment, how that's going to change, how that's going to adapt. We're now talking about 20-minute neighbourhoods, maybe more local centres. So there's a whole host of things there. And, we need to think And I think that's why we're bringing it to the government's attention, because we think we need to think fully about retail, town centres, you know, the future of offices. Are people going to get back and work full-time in offices? So there's a whole host of things there that, you know, could affect our future.
So in terms of there needs to be an alternative, both sort of in the longer term, what does that look like? But also, are there steps in the short term? So in the longer term, I mean, what should we, you know, be using as the basis for taxation? I mean, should there be some sort of generalised sales tax? Should rent be taxed directly? I mean, should that even, and I think I know your response to this next bit, should it actually be landlords to be taxed rather than the tenants? And I know you're going to say no, but nonetheless, I'll put it out there. And then finally, I mean, is there something we can do in the short term about, I think, addressing these online retailers? Could we create kind of a new category of either warehouse or retail premise that actually enables us to use the existing, albeit imperfect, regime to actually tax this massive increase in sales that the non-store retailers have experienced over the last 18 months?
Yeah, I think they're all good points that you've made. I think, you know, my simple answer is we need a review of the system, and we need to look at it holistically and look at the pros and cons of doing, you know, various tweaks or fundamental changes to the system. But I think at the moment, I think what we're seeing is the rental value basis, and the fact that rental values have historically been higher on retail, that's changing. So, you know, and if there was a revaluation, it's been put back to 2023, but if there was a revaluation, the take from existing retail is going to fall. But I think, again, we need to do a review, and I'm not quite sure what the procedure would be, but the thinking behind the internet retailers in big sheds paying effectively industrial just seems to be unfair when you look at the value, their turnover, relative to their overhead costs. So, but I think our review is what's required.
Thank you. I'm going to resist the temptation of having a rant about the revaluation process. I'll leave that for another day. But just finally, I'm just wondering if Joanne has any sort of thoughts or observations about the need for reform of non-domestic rates or any views about what should replace it.
Yeah, probably, again, not got significant amount to add to what Kevin has said there. I mean, obviously, there are other ways in which companies are taxed, some of which are not, you know, well, corporation tax, which isn't within Scottish Government's gift at the moment, Scottish Parliament's gift. So, and obviously there are sort of international negotiations ongoing about those things. And I suppose it's trying to do something holistic and meshing all of those in and seeing what is the best solution and whether it's a combination of those things. And clearly, yes, non-domestic rates may need to be reformed in some way, whether that's treating certain properties in a different manner or whatever.
Thank you very much. That's my rant over.
Not at all. Thank you very much, Daniel. And it's Michelle to be followed by Douglas.
Good morning. Firstly, Joanna, thank you very much for your submission. I enjoyed it greatly. But in the interest of time, I'm probably going to confine my questions to Mr. Robertson. Secondly, I should declare that I have an interest in some buy-to-let property, and I'm also an ambassador for the All-Party Parliamentary Group for Fair Business Banking, which is based out of Westminster. What I wanted to do, Mr. Robertson, was just gently challenge you on a discussion that came in earlier about your comment about the well-respected property legal system being undermined to changes to the landlord-tenant relationship, and this could create a barrier to much-needed future investment. I suppose my challenge is, in the light of the considerable uncertainty in the trading environment, surely as big a factor in that is access to finance for businesses and the risk appetite of lenders, be they private equity or banks. Would you reflect that was also the case?
Yeah, that's a fair point. I think when we're looking at this issue, then we also have to take into account that some of the people who are investors in existing property stock may have lending sources. And if the tenants are not paying the rent or have the ability not to pay the rent or to talk to or not being forced to talk to their landlord, then that might put individuals, companies, etc., who are property owners in jeopardy with the banks. So that is an issue, yeah.
Okay. And I suppose moving on to another area which we've not touched on yet, but I was interested in what reflections your organisation has made on the desire for home working, or at least a version of hybrid that we've seen, indeed, we ourselves today, and how that will cause and necessitate change of the people that you represent. What kind of reflections have you got on that?
It's quite a big subject in its own. It's all quite new, and I think we're all trying to find the new norm. And I think the new norm might differ for different organisations. You know, some organisations are seeing increased productivity by working from home. Others are seeing difficulty with it. Others are encouraging people to go back. I think our industry is still trying to come to terms with it, and we're looking at, you know, do we need more offices, or are office requirements going to shrink? In terms of house building, I think people are looking at introducing more space in houses for home working. So I think we're still in a state of uncertainty. We don't really know yet. But I think my own view is that we will see some businesses that will go for a hybrid model, some businesses that want 100% people back. That in itself might increase the demand, as people maybe want more space because we were getting squeezed into smaller spaces. But I think because of this pandemic, people might want more space. Just taking that a bit further, I think for our young people, we need people to be coming together for collaboration, for ideas. It seems to be that is good and healthy for business and for people's well-being. So I think generally we see there's still going to be a need for offices. The full extent of the pandemic is still to be worked out. But we're all working to see, and I think we've seen various comments from major internet companies saying they want all their staff back, other companies saying we're going to go a hybrid model, some people not working on a Monday, some are not getting into the office on a Monday. We're also, as a government, looking at a four-day working week and things. So I think there's a lot there, and I think what the pandemic has done is driven the debate forward, and we'll find out, you know, soon what the outcomes are going to be.
So, I mean, I take from that's an area that both you, on behalf of your members and your member organisation, will be reflecting on, given the long-term nature often of property. Okay, moving on from that, one of the themes I've been following up is that we know that diversity makes an economic contribution. So what reflections has the EPA made on supporting women-led businesses that you represent, given that this diversity gives economic contribution?
Yeah, I mean, the SPF and the BPF are a very inclusive organisation. One of the things when I took on this position, and I would say that my predecessor was a lady, and she was in a senior position in the property industry. We also have women in property in Scotland, and we're looking to broaden it because... Yeah, you're right. I mean, traditionally, property has been male-dominated, and we need to do more about that. As part of my tenure at the Scottish Property Federation, one of the things we're doing and encouraging is futures. And what we're doing is we're now engaging with the young people in property, because, again, I think we're quite an aged industry, and we're looking to bring forward people with less than 10 years' experience. We've set up a programme for mentoring, and that's all with a view to becoming more inclusive, but to get fresh ideas into the thinking. Your question about offices, about retail, all these things, I think we need fresher thinking from the young people who are going to be here a lot longer than I will be here. So that's part of our inclusive agenda and diversity.
Okay. Thank you for that. I mean, I assume from that you may look at the membership on your policy team that, when I checked out today, has 3 women to 23 men, so that's 13%.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
These things are all... I think we've seen through business, and it's not making excuses, but it's not happening as fast as it could potentially do. Okay. So it's something we're all working towards.
Thank you. Another area which kind of groups together, in your submission, you note the desire for increased capitalisation of the Scottish National Investment Bank, agree with, and also comment on the need for a national infrastructure agency, a view I also agree with. In the light of that, would you support increased borrowing powers for the Scottish Government to enable these much grander ideas? I'm a bit concerned that through the course of this discussion, we are tending to focus on these small taxes, LBTT and so on, rather than the shifts that really make a difference in terms of economic growth. So would you support that?
I wouldn't be against it, because I want to see Scotland thrive. I want to see our economy grow. I want to see us having a good quality of life. So anything that we can do to improve our economy and take Scotland forward, I would support.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Douglas.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Going back to domestic rates and empty properties again. I'm from the northeast of Scotland, and I've been really concerned over the last few years, the amount of, I wouldn't say old properties, commercial properties being knocked down just to save on domestic rates. And you know, I guess that's got an environmental impact. You know, new premises being knocked down, it's going to have an impact on the valuation role. And it all seems a bit short term. Is that something you would agree with? And what do you think could be done over the next couple of years to mitigate that?
It is a concern. I've went out to visit some of our towns at the weekend just to have a look and see how they're doing, and some of them look quite tired, quite sorry, and lots of agency boards on them for shops to let. Again, I think it indicates that, you know, people are trying to let these properties, but the demand is just not there, particularly during the pandemic. I share your concern that over time we will lose buildings because people, you know, can't afford to keep them. So what's the solution? We as an organisation are working, and we're collaborating with Scottish Government, Town Centre Initiatives. We're talking to the councils, and we're trying to come together to come up with ideas. Some of the things that are being talked about is like permitted development rights and things like that, to give owners the ability to develop these properties without needing a full a planning permission or a new to go through a formal application process. So there's various initiatives being looked at. I think, again, you know, we need government help and intervention. We need to improve our landscaping, our townscaping, our streetscapes, make the town centres more accessible. You know, we need to improve public transport, get people in there. We're not really encouraging cars in, so we need to get other ways to get people wanting to come back to the town centres. But I share your concern, and again, it's why we're highlighting the empty property rates, because we think that it's a disincentive to investment. And we think, for the reasons we mentioned about retail in time, we're going to see further decline in our built environment.
And has there been any analysis done on, obviously, that the valuation role has probably decreased because buildings have been knocked down, and I guess in town centres where buildings can't be knocked down because they're probably listed, there's still going to be a loss of income from that. Has there been any analysis done of what that's the impact on the Scottish Government's budget, that reduction in the role is going to have?
I don't have any figures for you in that. We're looking, and I'm asking to try and get more research done about impacts, you know, through COVID, and that might be one of the things that we can pick up, but I don't have any figures for you at the moment.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks very much. I'm just going to touch on a couple of areas that we've not covered so far, and one is that wee tax that Michelle mentioned, the land and buildings transaction tax, which still brings in a few bob. And I'm quite intrigued by the difference in the submissions in terms of this, because yourself, Kevin, you said that we're particularly concerned about the 10% tax band and believe that its threshold should be increased to £500,000.
However, Joanne, in your submission, you talk about that falling temporary relief of stamp duty, land tax, obviously, south of the border for first-time buyers. In 2010-2012, before LBT came in, HMRC undertook an evaluation and concluded that the majority of the 1% tax relief, between 50 and 70% of that, was in fact capitalised in higher prices. So I'm just wondering, Kevin, have you done any assessment on what the impact would be in terms of revenue for that? Because obviously there's not much point in us increasing the threshold to try and assist the sector if at the end of the day all it means is that prices are put up and revenue declines and no one's really any better off in that regard, surely.
No, we haven't got figures for you on that, but I could probably come back to you on it. We can try and get some calculations done. But our view was that is it inhibiting the ability of families to move to larger properties, because you have a 10% tax above 325, whereas if the some of our house values and prices now in some of our larger cities and suburbs are exceeding that, and we're just making the point that it might be helpful to families to think about that again.
And do you think it's LBTT or house price inflation that's more likely to inhibit people moving to larger properties in places like, obviously, we're talking obviously about Edinburgh, we're certainly not talking about North Ayrshire, where Alec was in. You can buy a palace for £500,000, never mind a house. I've got a five-bedroom detached house with garage and it cost me £145,000, so there's a big difference between house prices across the country. So what's your view on that?
We don't know for sure what the result has been of the measures taken during COVID. That previous research does suggest that you cut LBTT or SDLT, and I think it's partly because you're sending out the message to people that they're paying less tax on it, and so that creates higher demand, presumably. And so that pushes the prices up. So, in terms of what's stopping people moving, I think we have seen that there has been a suggestion prices have gone up quite significantly during this recent period where the LBTT was cut and where SDLT has been put in the rest of the UK. So Kevin has mentioned the point about potentially needing to review the rates and thresholds, and to some extent, yes, it has been in place since 2015. I think there have been changes since then, but yes, it is always important to if the average house price has now gone up significantly since the introduction of LBTT. There does have to come a point where you do review rates and thresholds to see if they still are relevant and appropriate. We would always suggest that you need to. That, I mean, I think obviously you mentioned earlier one of the ways of increasing the tax take from Scottish income tax would to just be to freeze the threshold, so that actually as people's incomes go up, they pay more. So, if that is a way of also increasing the tax take in any tax, but obviously we would suggest that you do need to review any amounts that are fixed in legislation, whether it's reliefs, whether it's thresholds, whether it's allowances.
Kevin, the high street's under pressure, we've already heard and discussed, and we've talked about a 50% increase in online sales. Now, if the UK government decided to tax online retailers to try and create a balance in the high street, is that something that you would support? And if so, do you feel that, therefore, some of the revenues thus raised should be assigned to the Scottish Parliament?
I would think that's fair, yeah. I mean, because, we are using these retailers in the dark buildings, etc. So I think if the UK government raised it, then it could be assigned to Scotland, yeah.
And Joanne, do you feel that if the UK did go down that road and assigned that, that would allow the Scottish Government to actually possibly even reduce rates in high streets in order to, if more money is coming in, for example, because obviously this isn't happening yet, but if it was done, then that would allow the Scottish Government an opportunity to reduce rates and make the high street more competitive?
Yeah, I mean, obviously it depends how it filters through in the block grant, but yes, potentially if you get more money from another source, then it allows you to look at reducing taxes in other areas or bringing in different reliefs to assist the changing the balance of the makeup of the tax resources that you've got.
Okay, and just lastly, Kevin, compulsory sales orders, it was a commitment, a manifest commitment of the SNP in 2016. It wasn't delivered in the last Parliament, partly because of the COVID pandemic. I've asked a written question about that. I was referred to a question submitted by Paul Sweeney, and then when I went to that question, it was this question has not yet been answered. So I'm just wondering if that's a body swerve there. So I'm just wondering whether or not compulsory sale orders is something that the Scottish Property Federation would support, because a lot of high streets and other streets, in fact, have been blighted by buildings that have been left 15, 20 years empty, and it's been difficult to actually get them moved on. So is that something you would support? I know in the last Parliament there was cross-party support for that.
Yeah. Is that compulsory purchase powers?
Compulsory sales orders.
Compulsory sales orders.
Yeah, so basically someone has got a derelict building they've been sitting on for 20 years, maybe an old primary school, an old pub, yeah. You know, a house, whatever, and they just aren't doing anything with it. Planning permission has long since passed away with nothing getting done, and they could be effectively, if nothing's done within 3 years to refurbish it, they could be forced to sell at auction or whatever. So we explored that at local government committee, and there was, as I said, cross-party support for that. So I'm just wondering if that's something that the Scottish Property Federation has looked at, mm-hmm. in terms of being able to help the high street, make it more attractive for people. And also, if Joanne's got any comments on that.
Yes, and it's something that I've worked with in the past. Sorry, I know it's compulsory purchase orders, and that's what we've implemented in the past. In
a CSO, obviously, you're not forcing someone, you're not buying, forcing
them to sell it, right? Yeah. I mean, we, again, in talking and part of our collaborative approach to working with the government and the councils, we look at all these options. And if someone was being deliberately obstructive to an overall benefit for a community or a high street, then we would support that they are forced to dispose of the property, or for the council or whoever to come in and buy the property to enable improvement to a town centre or another situation. Yes, so we would be in favour of that. Yeah, okay. We want to see good high streets, good public buildings. We want to see investment, and if people are blighting that, then we would be supportive of you know, there need to be the appropriate rules and regulations of how it goes about it, but the principle of it, we would support that, yeah.
Okay, thank you. And Joanne, last word to you.
I probably wouldn't comment on that. It's not really in our remit, so.
I wasn't sure, but I'll give you the opportunity anyway. So we've come to the end of our time now, so I'd like to thank our guests for giving the evidence, and of course particularly Kevin for coming in today. So I'll just have a 2-minute break to allow our witnesses to depart, and then we'll continue with the rest of the session. Thank you.